Imperial Mountains, but the dramatic rise in COVID cases in Southern California and the governmental edict that the players and coaches would not be able to have their family and friends in attendance made this move necessary. And what a temporary home we have, AT&T Stadium in Arlington, Texas. With its modern technology and amenities, it's the polar opposite of the Rose Bowl Stadium, but spectacular in its own way. It's still the Rose Bowl game. It's still about history, tradition, excellence, and meaningful games.
A new start. The next step. A challenge sought is here. A matchup that will mirror memories of greats.
Montana.
The crimson and gold.
Cornelius.
Their colors connect to legacy.
Derrick Henry.
There are new legends to create. Rich histories to update. The Rose Bowl. For over a century, a game as much about spirit as police.
White.
New year, old traditions.
In a game that'll be remembered for all
a
time.
A classic.
The Crimson Tide will not be denied.
Away. Locks off number one.
This is the Rose Bowl game presented by Capital One. And the first of today's two college football playoff semifinals. The number four team in the country, Notre Dame, making its second Rose Bowl appearance, its first since 1925, taking on the number one team in the country, the SEC champions, the Alabama Crimson Tide. Hi, everybody. Welcome. Sean McDonough along with Todd Blackledge. Happy New Year. Delighted to have you with us for the best day of the season for college football fans. It's Alabama and Notre Dame. Alabama, Todd, is a huge favorite. 19.5 points, the biggest in the seven-year history of the CFP. Understandably so. Right. They've won five national titles since 2009. Notre Dame has struggled on the big stages for the past couple of decades, including the last time we saw these two teams head-to-head. 2013 BCS National Championship game. Alabama dominated. So why might today be different?
Well, when Brian Kelly watched his number one ranked team get pushed all over the field that night, he came away and realized they had to change their approach to recruiting. They had to become a much more physical team in the trenches on both sides of the ball. They had to improve their overall team speed on defense. He feels like they've closed those margins with the elite teams, and I tend to agree with him. I think tonight they match up better, particularly the line of scrimmage, with this Alabama team than some people might think.
Yeah, Nick Saban agrees with that. He thinks it's a very physical Notre Dame team. They're a team that likes to possess the ball, run the clock, run the football, and Ian Book is a big part of all of that.
Well, he's their leader. He's 30-4 as a starting quarterback. He can make all the throws from the pocket, but what they're going to need from him tonight is to make some of the plays off schedule that he specializes. Some of his best plays happen outside of the pocket. He has a knack for extending plays, and when he does leave the pocket, he does a nice job of keeping his eyes downfield and his backs and receivers adjust with him on the move. We'll also see Notre Dame move him out of the pocket on purpose. He's very comfortable throwing on the move, change the launch points. And I think what we'll see a lot more of tonight will be called design quarterback runs. Alabama very aware of the lead draw. I think we'll see some quarterback counter, some quarterback power as well, because Ian Book has to be a factor in the run game tonight.
And of course, the biggest challenge for Notre Dame will be on defense. They have to contend with one of the best offenses in the history of college football. Three Heisman Trophy of the top five vote getters on this offense, including Mac Jones, the quarterback, first team All-American, Najee Harris, Alabama's all-time leading rusher, who can also hurt you in the passing game, and Devontae Smith, the wide receiver, the National Player of the Year by the Associated Press, trying to become the first wide receiver to win the Heisman Trophy since Desmond Howard back in 1991. That's unbelievable. Three of the top five vote getters in the Heisman on that offense for Alabama. So where do you begin? The coaches say it's with Devontae Smith.
Yeah, and stopping him is easier said than done, because he's had such a phenomenal year. He has an incredible skill set. But I think the thing that separates him is his high football IQ and how he studies coverages and understands how to attack defenders. Take a look at a couple of these plays. He knows where the defender is. He attacks the inside leverage, and then he has that burst to create separation. This next play, he's going to be in total sync with his quarterback. Reads the corner blitz, knows where the coverage is coming from, attacks the inside, and then fades back to the outside to give his quarterback a great target. He also has the ability to adjust in route. Watch him adjust to the depth of the linebacker on this crossing route. Alabama loves play action crossing routes. He sees the depth of the linebacker, goes behind, finds the open space for his quarterback, Mac Jones. He has been so fun to watch this year, Devontae Smith.
Certainly benefits from having a very accurate quarterback throwing that deep ball as we bring in Todd McShay. To me, Todd, in a lot of ways, Mac Jones reminds us of last year, LSU's Joe Burrow, who seemingly came out of nowhere. What is it that you like most? Why is Mac Jones so successful?
Well, first of all, Sean, starting the year, he was not on my draft board. Now he's number 32 overall, which means he could be a first-round pick. And what I love most about him is inside the pocket, his presence, feeling pressure, the ability to slide away from inside pressure, climb the pocket against outside pressure. And then you have to look at the matchup, though. Notre Dame knows that they have to get him off the spot. They've got to get him on the move outside the pocket to the right or to the left. And I think it's going to be really interesting to see how they try to do that, knowing that they have to double cover Devontae Smith the entire day.
All right, Todd, thank you. Alabama in the tunnel getting ready to take the field. And Notre Dame about to make its second appearance in the college football playoff in the last 3 years. But recent big games have not been kind to the Irish. And with more on the mindset of Brian Kelly's team, here's Allison Williams.
Prove you belong on this field. That was Notre Dame head coach Brian Kelly's final message to his team. All week, he has downplayed the national narrative that Notre Dame can't win the big game. But today, he tapped into it. He told his players, use that as your fuel. Let that give you the mental edge you need to win this game. He said, look, we have a lot of really good players. And yes, Alabama presents a tremendous challenge, but it is a great opportunity to go out there and earn the respect you deserve.
Nick Saban, 6 national championships, including one that he won at LSU, and Brian Kelly. And Notre Dame, Kelly won a couple of national titles back at Grand Valley State in Division II, obviously a much bigger stage here today. Here comes Alabama, perfect 11-0. Making their 6th appearance in the CFP in the 7-year history. The only time they missed was last year when they had an 11-2 season and basically thought that was pathetic. They have stormed back here. And Notre Dame trying to earn respect and prove that it is worthy of playing in these games and of its selection to the college football playoff. 2 years ago in this very stadium, the semifinal, they got trounced 30-3 by Clemson. Brian Kelly confident this time around it'll be different. The big reason that physicality 2 years ago, his offensive line was very young and inexperienced. All of those players now are seniors and graduate students. Captains coming to the middle of the field. For COVID reasons, only one captain for each side will step forward. You saw Robert Hainsey, a 2-time captain for Notre Dame, as is Ian Book. They are two of just the 24 players in the great history of Notre Dame to be 2-time captains. And
captains,
Alex Leatherwood, one of the best players
season
in the country out there for Alabama. John O'Neill is the referee.
Semifinal at the Rose Bowl. My name is John O'Neill. This is Brad Hudak. We are from the Big Ten Conference. Today we're flipping a special coin. On one side is the logo for the University of Alabama. On the reverse side is the logo for University of Notre Dame. When this coin comes to rest on the ground, whichever school's logo is face up, you have won the toss. Notre Dame, you have won the toss. You'll take the ball. Alabama, which way would you kick? Turn your back that way. to start the game. Notre Dame will receive in this end zone.
Brian Kelly said he is going to be aggressive and he wants the ball right away. We talk about the Rose Bowl being about history and excellence, traditions, and these two schools have as much as any. 10 Hall of Fame coaches combined, including legends Newt Rockne and Bear Bryant. They are two of the four winningest programs of all time by percentage. Ohio State number one, Boise State three. They've combined for 227 weeks atop the AP poll and 20 national championships. Doesn't get much more historic and tradition-laden, Todd, than that. About 17,000 fans in attendance here. Each school got 3,400 tickets. And this has been a busy venue. Two nights ago it hosted the Cotton Bowl. Cowboys have played a couple of home games in here in December. We were here on the 19th of December for the Big 12 championship game. They've had the Texas High School football playoffs in this building. So a lot of action here and another huge game tonight to ring in the new year. Chris Tyree back deep for the kickoff. And it'll be Will Reichert to kick it off. Not a lot of touchbacks, only 8 all year. They trust their ability to cover kickoffs. Brian Kelly hopes one of the places his team might have an advantage today is in special teams. And we're underway. The Rose Bowl and college football playoff semifinal. Tyree speedy and he got blasted and the ball comes out. And it's recovered by Tommy Tremble. Or excuse me, it's Jack Kaiser. They have two, number 24. He's a linebacker. And Josh Jobe sent an early message with the big hit. Now you know why they like to cover kicks. A poor field position for Notre Dame, led by Ian Book. Second all-time in Irish history in passing yards behind Brady Quinn. He's second in rushing yards, nearly 1,500, behind Tony Rice. And he has more wins as a starting quarterback than anybody in Notre Dame history. 30 wins, 30-4 all-time. This would be his biggest win by far. He comes out throwing and shows that ability to escape the pocket right away and ran ahead for about a 4-yard gain.
Good protection there on that first down play. Ian Book had plenty of time. Nobody open. One of the things we're going to see out of Ian Book in this offense is they are going to change personnel with their tight end. Now, they're starting the game in what we call 11 personnel, which is one running back and one tight end. They'll play two tight ends. They'll play three tight ends. Right now, they have multiple tight ends in, and Alabama's going to try to match that personnel all night. They have three tight ends in the game on second down.
And the handoff to Kyron Williams, outstanding sophomore running back. He tries to deliver a stiff arm to Jobe, and he goes down at the 27 with an Irish first down. ACC Rookie of the Year, Kyron Williams, as we look at today's impact players, brought to you by Chick-fil-A.
Well, Kyron Williams, one of those guys. He's a real tone setter for this offense. High emotion, did not have a great game against Clemson, and Patrick Surtain, maybe the best cover cornerback in all of college football.
Surtain, the first-team All-American. Book, is that pass backward? Officials conferring it was intended for Kyron Williams.
Is a backward pass out of bounds.
Well, that's a big ruling. It'll be a loss of yardage on the play back to the 22.
A good pressure. Book just trying to get rid of it. I think that's clearly a backward pass. And luckily for Notre Dame, it goes out of bounds. They lose the yardage, and they cannot afford negative yardage plays against Alabama. This is a team that has to stay on schedule, down and distance-wise and on the scoreboard.
There's Tommy Reese. He said he'd like to throw 10 passes to Kyron Williams today, like Najee Harris. He's an excellent pass receiver. That pass too high. Trying to go over the middle to another one of their big targets, Javon McKinley, who's 6'2".
Yeah, that was a ball that I don't think McKinley thought it was coming to him because it was high and behind him. I think he thought it was intended for Mayer, the tight end crossing behind McKinley. And that ball very nearly intercepted.
Another thing to watch here in the early going, each team playing with a backup center. They're both veteran offensive lines. That's Zeke Carell in there to start, making just his second start of the season. Jarrett Patterson out with an ankle injury, suffered mid-year. Book takes off running again and ducks down near the 30, but about 7 yards short of the first down. Daniel Wright made the play for Alabama.
See, third in that kind of distance is not how Notre Dame is built. Their offensive line is good. They're excellent run blockers. They're good in play action, but they have to stay ahead of the chains, and that's a difficult situation against this Alabama defense. Notre Dame very concerned about punting to Devontae Smith also.
He wants Jay Bramble just to hang it up high and not give Smith a chance to return it.
Wow, exactly
what
he did.
That was high and also deep by Jay Bramlett. He's a Tuscaloosa native. Here comes Mac Jones, redshirt junior from Jacksonville, Florida. Backed up most of last year behind Tua Tagovailoa. Became the starter when Tua went down, but had to re-earn that position, beat out an incoming freshman, Bryce Young, in camp. And boy, has he demonstrated that was the right decision. He's had four 400-yard passing games this season. That is the career record.
Yeah.
At Alabama, there have only been 10 400-yard passing games in school history. Najee Harris off a tremendous SEC title game against Florida. They faked it to him. Miller Forrestall, the tight end, catch and run. And a nice start for the Tide out to the 36-yard line.
Just such a great story when you consider Mac Jones. A lot of people thought Bryce Young, the five-star recruit from California, was going to win the job. And Mac Jones just refused to give it up. I mean, he competed every day, won the job, and he has still been a great mentor to Bryce.
He dumps it off to Harris. And he takes people with him. Maris Leafau and Nick McLeod finally got him down, but it's at midfield. He had three receiving touchdowns in that high-scoring win in the title game against the Gators on December 19th.
Yeah, he's just blossomed so much this year, become a more physical runner as well as the receiver out of the backfield and a pass blocker.
Jaleel Billingsley goes in motion. He's a tight end, but they play him all over. Terrific athlete. They even have him returning kickoffs as a tight end. Jeremiah Owusu-Koramoah, the defensive player of the year in the ACC, made the tackle.
And Sean, we talked about what does Notre Dame do to try to limit the effectiveness of a Devontae Smith. Well, Alabama's thrown three passes, none of them targeting Devontae Smith. So right now they're making Notre Dame realize, hey, if you give special attention to him, we have other guys who can make plays.
And lots of them. And a terrific offensive line as well, but they're without their usual starting center, first-team All-American Landon Dickerson. He's out with a knee injury, suffered against Florida. They blitz Jones. He spun away from it and hit Forrestall for another first down to the Notre Dame 37-yard line.
Well, this is the thing Todd McShay was talking about in the beginning that Notre Dame wanted to try to do, try to push him off his mark and make him uncomfortable and outside the pocket. That time, Mac Jones very smooth in getting his shoulders around and getting the ball to Forrestall.
Taking snaps from Chris Owens, a fifth-year senior offensive lineman, a backup through most of his career. They have faith in him. He's played a lot of football. Here's Harris up the middle, and he powers forward for a Bama first down. To the 26, there's Dickerson, watching from the sideline.
And that's the offensive line right there. Just their ability to get push and get some movement. And Najee just has such a good feel as a runner. He's, in my opinion, he's improved so much from a year ago. I mean, he was a third rounder coming into the year, and he's clearly the number one or number two running back in a first round pick this year.
Jones throws deep down the sideline, and it's broken up by the outstanding safety, Kyle Hamilton. Sophomore from Atlanta, first team all-conference, and a third team all-American.
He's so rangy at 6'4", 200 pounds. He gets there, uses that length to knock the ball away. Bolden was open, it was a good throw, but you see the closing ability of Kyle Hamilton.
We talk about the challenge for Notre Dame dealing with this Alabama offense. To me, Todd, the keys are Hamilton
and Owusu-Koramoah. Yep. They're basically hybrids. They can play all over the field. You can use them in a number of different ways and try to give the offense trouble. Quick throw. Here is Devontae Smith. Goodbye. Farewell. Touchdown.
Well, this is an RPO, and Mac Jones makes the perfect read. There's only two defenders. You can count on Devontae Smith to make one guy miss. That's Clarence Lewis, the freshman cornerback. There's only one other guy. The question is, did he step out of bounds? It doesn't appear so. But that was just a perfect read by Mac Jones. Give the ball or throw it to Devontae.
And Will Reichert adds the extra point. So the first touch of the game for the senior, Devontae Smith, winds up in the end zone. His 18th receiving touchdown of the year, adding to his Alabama record. Aerial coverage provided by Goodyear. Keep driving from the first kickoff to the final whistle. Goodyear, more driven. Sky's brightening outside AT&T Stadium. The roof closed. It's chilly outside in the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex. Temperature in the 40s today. Fast start for Alabama. Chris Tyree hopes this kickoff return is more pleasant than the first.
Alabama has their two starting corners running down on kickoff return.
They've used Devontae Smith as a gunner in punt coverage this year. It's a fair catch. They'll start at the 25. Time for tonight's Capital One easiest decision.
Placed at the 25-yard line.
Well, this was an easy decision because there's only two defenders out here, and this guy is the AP player of the year. These guys are out of the picture. So Mac Jones says, Notre Dame is defending run. I'll throw it to Devontae. He'll make one guy miss, picks up one block, and the rest is history. And that's the math problem that Notre Dame has. If they want to double Devontae Smith, they are short in the run game defense.
Michael Mayer, the freshman, tight end, went in motion. Here's Kyren Williams. He gets bounced down, but a quality gain of about 7 on first down for Notre Dame.
Very important for Notre Dame, I mentioned, to stay on schedule. That's down in distance, and it's the scoreboard. They're behind, but they got behind so quickly in the ACC championship game, and they weren't used to that. They don't play well that way. They've got to stay within striking distance of this powerful Alabama team.
Williams straight ahead for another yard. He got taken down by Brian Branch, a freshman defensive back. They have a couple of important players in that secondary, both true freshmen, Brian Branch and Malachi Moore.
Yeah, Branch did a great job just beating the block of Javon McKinley. McKinley's a much bigger guy, but Branch used his quickness to get inside and make that play.
Notre Dame will take its time. Brian Kelly said he'll be inclined to go for it on fourth down more frequently than usual, knowing they have to stay on the field, keep Alabama's offense off it. They brought some pressure, didn't get to Book, and a nice catch on a low throw by Michael Mayer, the tight end, true freshman from Independence, Kentucky, and Coach Kelly says he's the best freshman tight end I've ever had.
Well, he's working on Josh Jobe, who's one of those corners, but Jobe gives him some cushion. It's a good read, seeing the single coverage by Ian Book and getting the first down on third and short.
Gain of 6 on third down and 2. That's a big statement Brian Kelly made. They've had tremendous tight ends, and he had some at Cincinnati as well. Williams managed to get to the 46. They'll give him forward progress and another good first down gain of 7.
Brian Kelly said the difference in our team now is we can enter the C gap and have success. This is a run that goes into the C gap. The tackle tight end area, they get good push, they get good kick out blocks by those tight ends, and a good game.
Williams in trouble trying to turn the corner, and he cannot get away from Jordan Battle. Patrick Surtain came to his aid as well. Pete Golding, the defensive coordinator, gets a big play.
That was a decision by Kyren Williams to bounce outside. This play goes to go inside. Williams tries to go out, and Jordan Battle makes a nice play in the open field.
We talk about Notre Dame's belief. It's more physical. They can match up. They got shoved around a bit on that play, but that's just one round. Third down and 7. Excellent offensive line. Liam Eichenberg, the big left tackle, won the Jacobs Trophy as the best offensive lineman in the ACC. One of those design runs for Book. They get nowhere near the first down. Christian Barmore, defensive lineman, tripped him up.
I was interested to see if they were going to go. We talked to Brian Kelly, and he said, you know, a lot of times I go with the analytics and what they say, and every once in a while I'll just decide that I don't want to do it. I don't want to be aggressive. But he said, in this game specifically, we have got to extend drives. And I'm surprised he's not going for it here.
I think in his own territory with 5 yards to gain, a bit too much. Gabe Bramlett, the punter, is a Tuscaloosa, Alabama native.
Did that hit
ball might have
Alabama
hit somebody
player
in crimson. The Notre Dame people think so.
That's
regardless,
smart.
It's going to be downed at the 1 yard line.
Yeah,
the
regardless
player's looking up at the scoreboard to see if it touched somebody, and now the officials are talking about that.
Yeah, regardless of who it touched, it was smart by Notre Dame to cover the football. It could have been a Notre Dame player it hit, could have been an Alabama or nobody, but it still is smart.
Wow.
There's two Alabama players right there. The question is, did it hit Bolden or Josh Jobe? Either one of them probably shouldn't have been in that area anyway if you're Alabama.
Well, we'll take a look at that as we go to a break. Tom Herbert is the replay official. 7-0 Alabama just underway. The Rose Bowl game presented by Capital One.
Rose Bowl game presented by Capital One. What's in your wallet? And in part by Taco Bell's Nacho Fries. And AT&T 5G.
Rose Bowl game, also the first national semifinal. Alabama leads 7-0. Nearly a disaster here for the Crimson Tide, but after a replay review, it was deemed that that ball didn't strike anybody. Hard to believe it missed 4 players between the two teams.
This is an area where Steve Sarkisian trusts his quarterback to take a shot down the field on play action.
Najee Harris, lots of running room outside, and he runs over Kyle Hamilton to get to the 18 and a first down. We should also mention they did respot the ball from the 1 to the 3 where the Irish first touched it. Nonetheless, a 51-yard punt by Bramlett, followed by this 15-yard gain.
Really nice job blocking by Miller Forrestall, the tight end on the end of the line, and Devontae Smith even out there blocking on the perimeter as well. Again, the problem with defending this team, if you commit extra bodies to the run and Najee Harris, that leaves you in too many one-on-ones against Devontae Smith.
We'll go to the pistol now with Harris, the running back. Jones spinning and faking and completing to Devontae Smith. His second catch, this one good for 9. Nick McLeod there for Notre Dame.
And that's what makes him special. The ability to sink his hips, get in and out of breaks, and come back and make the catch. He reminds me so much of Marvin Harrison, the way he played.
There's Harrison, a Pro Football Hall of Famer. Here's Slade Bolden, who stepped in at the wide receiver spot after they lost Jalen Waddle in midseason to a fractured ankle against Tennessee. Waddle lightning quick. Bolden more of a possession type receiver, but he's an important player too.
Yeah, he is. I mean, he's filled in that gap of a possession slot receiver. There's Jalen Waddle. I mean, he was just as dynamic as you get in college football.
Waddle working his way back. It seems like he might be available for the national championship game in 11 days. Hurtling is Harris, and now running down the sideline. And he's chopped out of bounds deep in Irish territory. That's a man of 6'2", 230, who went up and over Nick McLeod.
That's just unbelievable.
First of all, it looked like he was going to lose yardage on the play. He bounces it outside and then instinctively goes right over McLeod and turns it into a huge run.
You saw the graphic. He's one of three finalists for the Doak Walker Award as the best running back in the country. You can go ahead and give him that one right now. No offense to Travis Etienne and Breece Hall, the other finalists. Play fake by Jones. Has a man wide open. Jaleel Billingsley, another Bama touchdown.
Again, Devontae Smith is going to draw double coverage back here. Here's Billingsley. He's going to cross to the other side of the field, and he's going to be wide open. Play action. Where's Devontae? We got him covered. Uh-oh, nobody on Billingsley, who has really become a go-to guy in this offense, another explosive weapon in this Alabama pass offense.
He had 12 catches for the season entering today, but 11 of them in the last five games. As he's gotten more comfortable, they've gotten more comfortable playing him. His third touchdown of his sophomore season. This is the first highlight reel play of these college football playoffs. 14-0 Bama. Worst possible start for Notre Dame. Business as usual for Mac Jones. 8 out of 9 for 97 yards and 2 touchdowns. Mentioned he's the most accurate passer in the country. Came in completing nearly 77% of his passes. 58% on balls thrown 20 yards or more down the field. That mammoth and talented offensive line certainly helps. Gives receivers time to get open. Gives him a clean pocket very often. He has weapons everywhere you look. Chris Tyree, another fair catch. Notre Dame desperately needs to put a drive together on the ropes early. When we're done here, the second CFP semifinal from the All-State Sugar Bowl, a rematch of a classic last year in the semifinals between Clemson and Ohio State. They've met 4 times previously, all in bowl games, all won by Clemson. And the Tigers are the favorite. Yeah. Although Tony Elliott, their play caller, will not be there after being testing positive for COVID. Here comes pressure off the corner. Ian Book gave it to Chris Tyree, who's ahead for about 3, tripped up by the tremendous freshman Will Anderson.
Anderson has had such a great year, and you know, when you talk to the coaches about what makes him special, well, he loves football, he loves to study. He's at a point now in the season where he understands what the calls are, and now he's focusing more on his personal technique. He's been an outstanding pass rusher and plays with a really high motor. Just a great future with Alabama.
Out of Hampton, Georgia. 2nd and 7. They stick with Tyree, true freshman running back. Book trying to set up a screen. Lots of running room and blockers for Tyree. And they're going to mark him out of bounds back at the 45-yard line. But the best play so far for the Irish, it goes for 27.
Very, very well conceived. They get the guard and the center out in front. Alabama completely caught out of position. And Tyree gets a nice play. And Sean, as we were talking in the break, this is an important, this has to be a touchdown drive for Notre Dame. They have to stay in striking distance of this explosive Alabama offense.
Tommy Tremble, one of their tight ends, the motion man. They stick with Tyree. He's to the 42, a pickup of 3.
So again, Notre Dame has got 13 personnel in the game, which is 3 tight ends and 1 running back. They don't just run out of that formation. Because those tight ends are all athletic guys, they can throw the football out of this formation. That's what gives them versatility.
Pete Golding said, when they do that, we're going to go to our hippo package. They usually play with 3 down linemen, but they send Tim Smith, number 50, in as their 4th.
Charge timeout, Notre Dame.
They'll basically play with 4 down linemen, 4 linebackers, and 3 defensive backs when the Irish go to three tight ends. Timeout, 2.5 to go first quarter, 14-0 Alabama. This is the Rose Bowl game presented by Capital One. Sean McDonough, Todd Blackledge, Todd McShay, and Allison Williams on the field. Our producer, Josh Hoffman, our director, Scott Johnson. Delighted to have you with us. Hope your new year is off to a great start. Game not off to a great start, but Notre Dame has crossed midfield for the first time on a well-executed screen pass. Ian Book looking at second down and 7 with Chris Tyree still the running back and Avery Davis, the slot receiver, the motion man. Tyree straight ahead across the 40. And here comes another third down. I think, Todd, this is an area where if they don't get it, Brian Kelly will go for it on fourth down unless they lose significant yardage.
Absolutely, and this is staying on schedule. Unlike the last possession, when Kyron Williams tried to bounce that second down play out and gave him a third and long and the quarterback run came up short, now they're in a position they can attack this third down play and come back with a fourth down play. And Brian Kelly said, my call sheet for fourth down for this game is longer than any game that we've ever had. Mm-hmm. So he's prepared for that.
As he said, he wants to eat clock. They average nearly 34 minutes of possession per game. Tyree looks like he has the first down to the 35-yard line, and it is first and 10, Fighting Irish.
That's an example of how this team matches up a little bit better with Alabama. They run over their left guard, Aaron Banks. Zeke Correll, the center in there, and they get good push for the first down. Now let's see if Tommy Reese has a little play action and try to get a chunk play against this Alabama defense thinking run.
They've used Correll and Josh Lugg at center since Jared Patterson went down midseason.
Avery Davis is the guy that I think can make something happen.
Here's pressure on Book. It's Jordan Battle on a safety blitz, and Book throws it away.
There's no foul for intentional grounding. The passer was out of the pocket, and the ball crossed the line of scrimmage. Second down.
Here's Battle. He's coming here. Now they're bringing the backside guard to pick this up, but he's just, Aaron Banks is just a little bit late getting there, and Battle is able to force Ian Book out of the pocket, and Ian does the smart thing, getting rid of the football.
It was Aaron Banks, the outstanding guard, first team consensus All-American, number 69, trying to help. High snap, slow developing play, but here comes Kyron Williams. Nearly gets the first down, chopped down by DeMarco Helms, a backup safety. Third and less than a yard here for Notre Dame in the final minute of the first quarter.
Yeah, this play did not look like it was going to end well at all. The timing was all messed up, but Kyron Williams, showing some nifty footwork in the hole, gets the first down.
Christian Harris didn't get him down. There's a big hole on the left, and Williams almost took it the distance. Christian Harris dragged him down to the 20.
Sean, you mentioned when Notre Dame played in the college football playoff in 2018 against Clemson, four of these offensive linemen started the game as sophomores. They're seniors now. They're veterans. They're bigger and stronger. Liam Eichenberg and Aaron Banks just opened up a beautiful hole on that play.
That's the left side of the offensive line, both all-conference. Tommy Kramer, the right guard, first-team all-conference. The right tackle, Hainsey, has started 34 games. Experienced and talented, but down 14 to nothing. It's the Rose Bowl game presented by Capital One and the College Football Playoff semifinal.
Well, Notre Dame desperately needs a touchdown here. Red zone efficiency, as good as their season has been, the touchdowns have not been as good as you would expect, especially with a quarterback who can run like Ian Book. The 3 years prior to this, very high percentage. This year at 59%, they've got to find a way to score here in the red zone.
It's been a problem all year. We did their game at Boston College midseason. Brian Kelly said, we're going to worry less about plays and more about players. Like a power play in hockey, we're going to get our best players on the field when we get in the red zone. They have the big people on the field. Nice catch, Kyron Williams, and a good tackle by Dylan Moses, the senior linebacker who's come back from a knee injury that cost him all of last year. He's kind of felt his way along as the season's gone, but certainly provides leadership to those around him.
We've seen one quarterback called run on a third and eight. It was a quarterback sweep. This might be another opportunity for it for Ian Book. Something where you get a couple lead blockers in front of him.
Tremble and Mayer, the tight ends, shifted to the left. Williams trying to escape outside, and Josh Jobe, another good tackle. Junior from Miami, first year starter at cornerback for Alabama.
Kyron Williams is running hard. I mean, he and Tommy Tremble are the trend setters, the tone setters for this offense with their energy, with their passion. He is running hard, held to 50 some yards against Clemson a week ago. He's off to a pretty good start against this Alabama defense.
He's a redshirt freshman, played in four games last year and redshirted. Got much slimmer and stronger. And he carries on third and two for the first down. Well, this is what Brian Kelly had in mind, a methodical, time-consuming drive. And you can see the physicality of the offensive line on this possession.
We're seeing that. And then the other reason you want to have a drive like this is you have to limit the opportunities that Alabama gets on offense, because as good as Notre Dame's defense has been all year, they don't match up well with the perimeter with this Alabama team.
Well, the cornerbacks are certainly the weakness of the Notre Dame defense, and that's a big problem when you play Alabama. Devontae Smith and the others, they had the three tight ends in there again, and Kyron Williams chopped down for no gain by Christian Harris, sophomore from Baton Rouge. There's their second leading tackler for the year, Will, linebacker. And Tremble, part of that talented tight end trio, limps off. Very important blocker in the run game.
Yeah, he's an outstanding blocker. I mean, you usually find the ball when you find him in the running plays. Tommy Rees wanted to use him more in the passing game tonight, but he's being helped to the bench.
13th play of the drive. They've had it for more than 6 minutes. Caught by Williams, and he's smothered at the three. You don't get away very often from this solid tackling, tied defense. That time it was Dylan Moses and DeMarco Helms.
See, this is a matchup that favors them. This is Dylan Moses. Now, Moses is actually going to get away with a penalty here. He reaches and grabs, which he does a lot when he feels like he's beat. That's a penalty. They still get the completion to Kyron Williams, but it might have given him a first down with the penalty.
Tommy Rees said he wants to get Kyron Williams involved in the pass game. He actually said maybe 10 catches in this game for him.
Third down and goal. Approaching 7 minutes on the drive, and a timeout called by Ian Book.
Charge timeout. Notre Dame, this is their second. A full media timeout.
Might as well use it. This is a very big play early in the second quarter. Alabama leading 14-0, but the Irish are knocking on the door.
The national championship game, Monday, January 11th on ESPN.
Well, Tommy Tremble, who is such a key to their run game, got rolled up. He's in the tent right now, had to be helped off the field.
Because Notre Dame called
the
timeout.
And, you know, you wonder what Brian Kelly, how he has to adjust now on third down and fourth down if they don't make it here.
Well, they have five tight ends who all play. Some of the backups not as talented as Tremble. Design run for Book. Ian Book to the goal line. And they're marking him down short. Irish fans and players thought it was a touchdown.
I think he's in. Sean, I think he got in. I mean, we'll take a look, and I'm sure they'll take a look. He's protecting the football. Well, that could be a good call. The butt is down. Does the ball, all it has to do is break the front of the plane.
If I were Notre Dame, I wouldn't be in a hurry. They're lined up like they want to go fast.
That ruling is under further review.
Now, the official who marked it was from the near side. You see him running into the shot there, the AT&T 5G pylon cam. And I don't know how he could have seen the ball.
Right, he saw the rear end.
Guess where the ball was based on where he saw Book hit the ground with his backside there.
And see, the ball's in his up by his numbers, up by the shoulder. He's carrying it with both hands. From my vantage point, I thought the ball broke the plane as his butt was hitting the ground, but it was ruled down inside the one.
Well, here's the view from the opposite side. Where is the ball? It doesn't look like his backside is on the ground yet.
Wow, that's close. And again, it just has to break the front part of the plane to the goal line.
Let's bring in our rules expert, Matt Austin. Matt, what do you think? Ruling on the field, no touchdown.
You guys
see anything to change it?
I really don't. Nothing definitive. You guys have nailed it. If that ball just touches the front edge of that line, it's a touchdown before his bottom hits the ground. From this view, you can't tell. From the other side, it was a little fuzzy. And if it's not definitive, the call's going to stand.
And they were already going to go for it on fourth down. Yep. Brian Kelly said he would. He knows they need to score touchdowns.
Well, if it's fourth down, it's less than a yard. Ian Book is not the biggest guy. If you go quarterback sneak, Kyren Williams is your go-to back.
The ruling on the field of the runner down short of the goal line stands. Fourth down.
Tom Herbert, the replay official, that seems like the right verdict. So now, if you're Brian Kelly, you say to your team, okay, we keep saying we're more physical.
Yep.
Here's the chance to prove it.
And remember now, Notre Dame playing with four veteran linemen, but a new center, Zach Correll. It's not Jarrett Patterson, who was their starting center for most of the season.
Fourth and goal. Magnificent drive. Will it yield points? Yes, it will. Kyren Williams slides into the end zone for a Notre Dame touchdown.
Really good push up front. The left guard, the left tackle, the center, Correll. They get the push, and they win the battle right here. There's that physicality that Brian Kelly was hoping to see, and it pays off on a fourth and goal touchdown for Notre Dame.
Kyren Williams, his 13th rushing touchdown of the season, leads all freshmen nationally in that category. He was one of the 10 semifinalists for the Doak Walker Award.
He already
has the best running back in the country.
Already has more yards in this game than he had last week against Clemson in the ACC championship game. So a little chip on his shoulder coming into the ball game tonight.
Jonathan Dorr, the extra point. What a drive. 8 minutes and 3 seconds. 15 plays to go to 75 yards. And they've made a game of it again here in the opening moments of the second quarter. And you have to wonder, because of the history, what the mindset is. It feels like they really needed that mentally as well. Last time they played, 2013 BCS National Championship game, Eddie Lacy. Magnificent. They scored touchdowns on their first three possessions. It's Amari Cooper from A.J. McCarron that made it 35-0. They completely dominated, winning 42-14, their second straight BCS championship. And unfortunately, part of a bad recent history for the Irish in BCS and New Year's Six games over the last couple of decades. 0-6, no game closer than 14 points, outscored by 144 combined. That's an average of 24 points per game. They believe they're different in many ways. And that was a statement early in this game they just made there.
It was. And again, Brian Kelly, the term that he used when he talked to us a couple times this year was closing those margins. He actually felt the margins were closer when they lost to Clemson. And really, that game started out differently than the scoreboard ended up indicating. But that drive right there was very important for the confidence of this Notre Dame football team.
That is Jaleel Billingsley, a tight end, back for the kickoff from Jonathan Dorr. And he stumbles down near the 15. Here's Allison Williams.
Hey there. Sean, when Notre Dame Dame's defense came off the field, which seems like about 2 hours ago, Coach Kelly spent a lot of time with his safety, Kyle Hamilton, and breaking down what he saw. And then he addressed the entire secondary, and he tried to simplify what they were seeing from Alabama. He told his guys, look, we've gone over this. It's not that complicated. You need to just go out there, settle down, and do your job. And they are pleased with the physicality up front. That was such a major storyline coming into the game. And the coaches told the defensive line, look, the ball's getting out on the perimeter, but keep your eyes up and stay physical.
Long time on the sideline for Mac Jones and the Tide offense. Last time they're on the field, they went a long way in a short amount of time. 97 yards in five plays. Jones, not much of a runner, but he went ahead for five. And by the way, that 97-yard drive last time out, second longest in Rose Bowl game history. Washington State went 99 in a loss to Michigan. And our pal Brian Greasy in 1998. Big part of that drive was the 53-yard play by Najee Harris. Longest run of his career. John Metchie, the receiver. There's Steve Sarkisian, the offensive coordinator, and winner of the Frank Broyles Award this year as the top assistant coach in the country. He called for quick tempo there and a sneak ahead for a first down.
He's had a brilliant year, and Nick Saban has so much confidence in him. Says he's a great play caller. The other thing he said to us yesterday, he says he always has answers for our players. Anything that there's an issue, a question about why we're doing this, why we're calling this play, he has answers for the players, and they love him.
Irish showing blitz. They brought pressure. Jones threw away from it to Devontae Smith, who's taken out of bounds across midfield by the sixth year senior Sean Crawford.
Now you wonder where Devontae Smith improved from last year to this year. He will tell you that some of the new emphasis in their strength and conditioning, that initial burst, he is quicker in his first couple steps than he's ever been in his career.
24-yard gain to the Irish 49. 9.5 to go till halftime. Mac Jones sees weapons everywhere he looks. And how about that catch by Jaleel Billingsley? Looked like Crawford had excellent coverage, and somehow the tight end came down with it.
Yeah, that's just a ridiculous catch. Crawford is there, probably getting away with interference, and somehow Billingsley still makes the catch. And he's listed as a tight end, Sean, but at 6'4", 230, and with the speed he has, he's just a big receiver. Is skilled.
Just what they needed, another weapon.
Yeah.
Over the second half of this season. Fake to Najee Harris and the quick strike to Devontae Smith. And he is in for a touchdown. And he is slow to get up.
Well, again, it's RPO, which means there's a run play called. And Mac Jones is reading and counting numbers. And Notre Dame had more numbers committed to stop the run. And he just raises up and throws the quick slant to Devontae Smith. It's doomed if you do, doomed if you don't, if you're Notre Dame. I mean, how do you defend an offense this explosive and a quarterback who's smart enough to recognize how you're trying to, what you're trying to take away?
Seems to be all right now as he walks along their sideline. Four catches for 93 yards and two touchdowns. That was a 34-yard score, and Will Reichert adds the extra point.
This guy is impossible to single cover. You got to try to get hands on him. You got to try to get another body over the top. Notre Dame does really neither, and Devontae Smith makes him pay with his second touchdown catch of the day.
The Rose Bowl game presented by Capital One is brought to you by Cheez-It, cheesy, crunchy satisfaction. Allstate, you've never been in better hands. And Bolt 24, real advanced hydration from the makers of Gatorade.
Well, we had the Cotton Bowl here a couple of nights ago. the team here at AT&T Stadium yesterday, taking that logo off and putting that beautiful Rose Bowl game logo on the field here in Arlington, Texas, where Alabama's had it three times. They've scored three times. They're averaging 14 yards per play. Devontae Smith went to the medical tent. It looked like it was a lower back concern when he slammed to the ground after his second touchdown. He's now on the bike, as you saw. And Will Reichard kicks it. And Chris Tyree calls for a fair catch.
Well, it's almost unfair to defend these. They're going to pull the guard and the tight end. So this says run, right? And that affects these three linebackers. They have to respect the run. Well, as soon as that happens, then Mac Jones knows he has single coverage outside. Everybody's up for the run. They throw the touchdown. And at the end, Devontae Smith takes a hard fall, but not before he had crossed the end zone.
Well, Notre Dame had an 8-minute touchdown drive last time out. Can they do it again? Quick toss to Kyren Williams. Nice cut. We've got four. Will Anderson made the tackle. Here's Allison.
As you guys could see, it was a bit of a back injury for Devontae Smith. They're continuing to massage the lower back area, but I am told he's able to return to play.
You know, the disconcerting thing for Brian Kelly and Notre Dame and Clark Lee, the defensive coordinator, is
things.
Their defense was rested,
yes.
Right? I mean, it wasn't that they were fatigued or gassed. They just don't have answers right now at all for Alabama's offense. So Ian Book and this Notre Dame offense have got to find a way to keep scoring. And Brian Kelly told us, we have to score points, but we can't let it become a track meet because we can't win that. And right now, it's threatening to become a track meet.
Will Anderson, a nice tackle to stop Kyren Williams for a 2-yard pickup. A lot of coaches say that time of possession is overrated. Alabama certainly making it look like it's not all that important right now.
Yeah, but it's part of Notre Dame's identity. I mean, that's mm-hmm. who they are.
It's worked very well for them. 10-1, only loss in the ACC championship game. There's George Takacs, a backup tight end, getting more time here without Tommy Tremble in the game. That's just the third catch of the season for the junior from Naples, Florida. Just his fifth career catch.
Nice job reading the coverage by Ian Book, and really nice job by Kyren Williams also picking up the blitz. There's Tremble putting his helmet on, but he is definitely hobbling and such a valuable part of this offense, run and pass.
Play to Takacs, good for 10. They empty the backfield. Kyren Williams takes the swing pass. Boy, they're great tacklers, aren't they? As a team, Dylan Moses, the tackle. Just a 1-yard gain.
I still think this is a matchup, even though Moses wins it this time. I think this is a matchup in the passing game that Notre Dame has to try to exploit. If they can get Kyren Williams matched up inside, running option routes or angle routes against Dylan Moses, I think Kyren Williams wins most of those battles.
Notre Dame coaches said they wanted Williams to have 10 catches. He has four already, but just for 14 yards. They try him on the run, and he's taken down by Christian Barmore. He's come back from a knee injury in the preseason to have a terrific year, third team AP All-American.
Yeah, Barmore, earlier in his career, he's always been a dynamic pass rusher, but he tried to kind of rush the passer on every play. And that made it difficult for him to play on first and second down. He's become a much more solid defensive lineman against the run. And that's led to his season this year.
Third down and 8. And again, they spread the field with 5 receivers. Ian Book, under duress, completes it over the middle, and then incomplete, came out of the hands of Avery Davis. If they had caught it, it would have been short of the first down, but in the distance, about 2 yards, Brian Kelly would have had a tough decision to make.
Only a 4-man rush, but a nice stunt. Watch the inside stunt. That time, that was Christian Harris, who got right into the lap of Ian Book, and Avery Davis not able to come up with the catch.
He never actually had it. There's Jay Bramblett. Well, was a quarterback in High School in Tuscaloosa. And he did his job, keep it away from Devontae Smith. He took one back 84 yards for a touchdown against Arkansas earlier this season. This is the Rose Bowl game presented by Capital One.
Run to Taco Bell.
The Rose Bowl trophy will be presented to the winner, and along with it, a ticket to the national championship game in Miami on January 11th. Right now, it's Alabama leading 21-7. They've scored all three times they've had it. Najee Harris weaved through the Irish defense to the 30 for a first down pickup of 7, taken down by the inside linebacker, Drew White.
Well, only a 7-yard gain is half of what they've been averaging per play. Heading into it, that's their 19th play. Take a look, pretty efficient offensive possessions. Notre Dame just not able to pressure, not able to stop the run, just really no answers right now.
Averaging 49.7 points per game. Harris trying to get the first down, might be just short. When we asked Nick Saban about Steve Sarkisian's offense yesterday, Nick's been 25 years a college football head coach. Is this the best offense you've ever coached? He said, I don't compare teams. And he said, last year might have been better.
When Tua was healthy.
Mm-hmm. Mac Jones carries for the first down. Well, they're averaging 49.7 this year, so that would be the single season mark. But they're number two in the country. Do you know who number one is in this weird year of college football? No. They've only played 4 games. Kent State.
Oh.
Nick Saban's alma mater.
The Flashes.
49.8. Tenth of a point more. They went 3-1, back-to-back winning season for Kent State. For the first time since the mid-70s, Najee Harris tackled by Shane Simon. So now, there's that question. You know, Ohio State, they only played 6 games. Should they be in the playoff? Now people around the country say, wait a minute, Kent State, they only played 4 games. You're going to say they're the national scoring leader? That's not our job to decide.
No, we just read the numbers. We just.
We're the messenger.
We are.
Don't kill the messenger.
Don't shoot the messenger.
You don't like the message.
Right. You know what's scary to think about with this Alabama offense is how good they would still be if Jalen Waddle was still healthy. I mean, as good as they are, you add him back to the equation.
That wouldn't be fair.
It's lights out.
It's already really not fair. Najee Harris takes the screen. Well defended there by the Irish. Drew White forced the play. There's Jalen Waddle. Electric wide receiver. And special teams player. He was the special teams player of the year in the SEC last year. Blazing speed. And I still think, you know, they weren't saying anything when we spoke to the Alabama coaches. But we asked his buddy, Devontae Smith, do you think he'll be back if you get to the championship game and we can hear the sports information staff telling him don't answer that question?
Maybe he's doing a little bit more than just running on dry land.
Irish fans hoping for a stop. Mac Jones completes to Devontae Smith just beyond the sticks. Sean Crawford made the tackle, but they pick up the first down with a yard to spare.
See, with Devontae's football IQ, Steve Sarkisian has been able to move him all over the field. That time he was an inside slot receiver. Last year he was an outside receiver primarily. Waddle was a slot guy. When Waddle got hurt, Devontae just took on a whole new role of moving all over the field, and his football acumen has allowed him to do that.
5 catches, 101 now, and 2 touchdowns. Najee Harris, they thought they had him stacked up. Still managed to get to the 48. Yeah, we heard from Todd McShay talking about Devontae Smith, his attributes. Obviously, the blazing speed is there. He's an elegant route runner. But the first thing Steve Sarkisian said was his intelligence. Yep. Not only can we play him everywhere, but he understands why we're playing there, what he's supposed to do within play and where he is, and how to run your route based on the coverage that you see.
Yep. And to me, again, that's what I think makes him unique. That's unique for college football wide receivers. Most college football receivers just tell me the play and let me run it.
Now they flip it to him. Deeper into the bag of tricks. And the Irish swing him down. Kyle Hamilton, the safety, drops it for a loss.
And I think it's interesting, just the wide receiver room. The last couple of years, you think about Henry Ruggs a year ago and how hard he played and how hard he blocked and how competitive he was. Jerry Jeudy is another first-round pick. They've got two first-round picks on this team, obviously, with Waddle not playing, but they hold each other accountable.
Yeah, matter of fact, Devontae told us yesterday, I'll come off the field and Waddle will tell me what I did wrong.
Yeah.
And we said to Devontae, well, he can't have much to say because you haven't done much wrong this year. Third and 12 and a timeout.
Alabama, they're first. This is a full media timeout.
We'll see if Coach Waddle has some advice as they head toward third and 12 with under a minute to go till halftime. Aerial coverage provided by Goodyear. No matter what the season throws your way, keep moving forward. Goodyear, more driven. Saturday, starting at 4 Eastern time, the PlayStation Fiesta Bowl, Oregon and Iowa State. Followed at 8 by the Capital One Orange Bowl. North Carolina, terrific season in the Orange Bowl for the first time. Texas A&M, number 5 in the country, first out of this playoff.
There's Devontae. They put him in that formation because it's harder to double or jam him. Can't let him beat you on this play.
Third down and 12. Back shoulder throw intended for John Metchie. Alabama sideline wanted a flag on Nick McLeod. They don't get it, so Alabama stopped for the first time in this half with 51 seconds to go.
Notre Dame able to get a little pressure. They've not been able to do that. That's only the second pass that Mac Jones has missed. Enough pressure to make him uncomfortable and not make a good throw to Metchie.
Bama fans wanted a flag on the replay. There's not been a penalty in this game. Officials have let them play in a cleanly played game. Charlie Scott, the punter. Another guy who's probably bored much of the time.
Hell yeah.
Matt Salerno made the fair catch. So Todd, I think we both thought when we saw this matchup that Notre Dame was more physical. Yep. They could compete in that area, but the big concern would be the secondary, particularly the cornerbacks. Clark Lee said, I don't think it's a weakness, but it's not a strength.
Right.
And they're having a tough time, as you might expect.
Well, and when they do try to add coverage outside, Najee Harris has made some incredible plays running the football. Again, it's just such a difficult offense to defend. And Notre Dame's margin for error on both offense and defense is so slim in a game like this. And they've got to find a way to stay in it.
And if you try to blitz, there's that mammoth offensive line. It's tough to get around. Ian Book. He's also going to ask you about the mindset here. There's limited time and one timeout, but Alabama's going to get the ball first in the second half. Do you try to do something here even though you're deep in your own end?
Well, you always see if you can get one first down. If you can get one first down, maybe you get a little more aggressive. You got one timeout. Second and short, a lot will depend on what the result of this play is. Will determine what Notre Dame does.
9-yard gain. That was a design quarterback draw for Book. And he slides down head first at the 40. Brian Kelly wants him to spike it. They are going to try to move
now
here
do.
Now.
Now you do. I mean, you got a good gain. You're out near midfield. You keep that timeout in your back pocket. You know the clock stops on a first down. And this is the play that Nick Saban was most concerned about, the lead draw. You got two linemen and the running back leading the way. A perfect setup for that play on second and short for Ian Book. Has a receiver made a play at all for Notre Dame in this game?
It's not a strength of that team as well. Book on target to Ben Skoranek, the transfer from Northwestern. He's at the 40. 19 seconds to go. Stop the clock to move the chains. He'll spike it again.
Again, working inside. That time against the freshman Brian Branch. It's hard to work on these corners, Job and Sertan, on the outside. But inside, you have some matchups that favor you. Branch trying to cover Skoranek. Skoranek makes the catch.
And to answer your question, that is the first catch by a Notre Dame tight end today. Wide receiver today.
Yeah.
The big Skoranek. Just about on the edge of field goal range. Book can't take a sack. Throws a shovel pass, and he should not have tried to catch it.
Should not have tried to catch
Tyron
it.
Tyron Williams caught it. Now if
they have to use their timeout now. I mean, they can't spike it. They have to use their timeout.
He's on the ground. He's going to be marked down where he catches it. If he does catch it.
To Notre Dame, their third and final timeout.
He needs to let that hit the ground.
But again,
easier
in the heat of the moment.
Done.
Yeah. I was going to say, you know what? I need to drop this one. I'm going to drop this one. And yeah, that would have been the smart thing. Ian Book trying to avoid
Notre
the
Dame.
Sack.
He's smart. Okay. Game situations. Situational football, complimentary football. Let's bring out all the cliches on day one of this new year.
Yeah.
And let's hope that this new year, it can only be better. But let's hope it's a return to normal for everyone around the world.
Well, let's talk about this situation here a little bit. Third and 11, you've used your timeout. So now you either have to work the ball. You need more yardage for a field goal attempt, right? You
just a little, though. We asked Brian Kelly the other day. He said in their indoor facility, which mimics this, their kicker, Jonathan Doerr, was good from about 55 or 56. This would be 57, 58.
Well, if you're not throwing beyond the first down marker, you've got to keep it on the sideline because you can't spike the football. It's third and 11. There's Alabama knows that as well.
They rush for Book to Williams.
Good play.
And now the decision. It's fourth down. Take the points.
Yeah, you got to try to kick it here. You need some momentum to go into the locker room with. This was a good response drive. You want to stay within striking distance. 21-10 sounds a lot better than 21-7.
Saw Brian Polian, special teams coach, wave out the kicking unit. So this is still going to be a 51-yarder, which would match his career long set in the last game against Clemson. Outdoors in Charlotte when he set the ACC championship game record for the longest field goal with that 51-yarder. He's been a little shaky lately. That's a knuckleball that is nowhere near enough. And he's now made just four of his last nine field goal tries.
Snap is good. Hold looks down.
Just a bad kick low. It might have been deflected.
Yeah, I think Will Anderson might have got a paw on it a little bit.
Had to drive it low on a long attempt. Doerr got off to a good start this year. We said 50-50 lately, and that's not good in today's football. Well, these kickers are so outstanding. Mac Jones takes the knee. He went 14 for 16 for 182 and three touchdowns in the half. Devontae Smith, five catches, 101 yards and two touchdowns. Najee Harris, seven carries for 93, including a career-long 53. Here's Allison Williams.
Coach Saban, you said that Devontae.
I can't hear you.
You said that they were going to. Can you hear me now? No.
What?
You said that they would try and take away Devontae Smith. Why have they not been able to do that?
What?
What's been the key to keeping Devontae Smith so involved with this offense?
Well, we always move him around, so it makes it hard for him to double him, but. You know, we got to keep playing on offense. We got to get some stops on defense. Last couple times they've been moving the ball on us. So they got a good plan. We got to make some halftime adjustments.
What are the key adjustments you need to make?
Well, I think they're getting in some unbalanced stuff that, you know, we're not familiar with. So we'll work on it at halftime.
Okay, thanks, Nick.
Thank you.
We saw the numbers when leading at the half. As Tommy Tremble limps to the locker room, doesn't look like we're going to see him again. They've also won 39 in a row when they score a touchdown on their first offensive possession, which they did today. We'll send you to Rhys Davis, Desmond Howard, and David Pollock after these messages. 21-7 Alabama at the break. This is the Rose Bowl game presented by Capital One. AT&T Stadium in Arlington, Texas, the first of today's college football playoff semifinals. Alabama leading Notre Dame as we head for the second half. It's 21-7. Welcome back. Happy New Year. Sean McDonough, Todd Blackledge. Notre Dame got one stop there at the end of the half, and they're going to be on defense again to start the second half.
Yeah, and they almost have to get another stop here because they don't have a lot of answers for this explosive Alabama offense. And it's kind of the same problem they had in their last game against Clemson. The Tigers had 9 plays of 20 yards, and 4 of them were for touchdowns. And so far in the first half, Alabama 4 plays of over 20 yards, 2 of them touchdowns on receptions by Devontae Smith.
And Brian Kelly thought that conference championship game against Clemson was a bit of an aberration. Devontae Smith did a lot of stretching before the second half began. And he thought they knew they were going to get into the college football playoff no matter what, and they had already beaten Clemson, and maybe they weren't as focused as they should be. He didn't think that's who they are. And they've played better than that here today. And they're dealing with one of the great offenses in the history of college football. Jonathan Doerr's kickoff is a fair catch made by Jaleel Billingsley. And here's today's AT&T countdown to the CFP National Championship.
Well, the Big Three has shown up again. It seems like every time there's a big game for Alabama, the Big Three shows up. Najee Harris, 7 carries, 93 yards. Mac Jones, almost perfect, 14-16. Devontae Smith, a couple touchdown receptions. And again, if you're Notre Dame, what do you try to take away? It's a very, very difficult task indeed.
He was banged up on that second touchdown. They did a lot of extra stretching just before the start of this half. Might be tight. Najee Harris for 2. And Jeremiah Owusu-Koramoah made the stop for Notre Dame.
One thing Notre Dame did in that last possession where they got a stop, they got a couple negative yardage plays, and they were able to get a little bit of pressure on Mac Jones.
Well, you want to help your secondary, which isn't a strength of your team, but you're at the point now where you need to take some chances. It is the pistol. Mac Jones faked it to Najee Harris, lofts one down the middle, and what a catch by Devontae Smith, up into the air and down with it to the 49-yard line.
Yeah, this ball really kind of floated because Mac Jones, his arm was hit right as he threw it. But Devontae Smith was still able to go up and collect the football. Watch
the back
press.
Looked okay there on that jump.
See, Mac Jones was not able to get the ball out cleanly. Logan Dagey with good pressure. But Devontae Smith working on the true freshman Clarence Lewis. That's an all-day task.
Najee Harris across midfield. When we spoke to Clark Lee the other day, the defensive coordinator, about the defensive back, so he was didn't want to say it's a weakness. He said it's not a strength, and we are playing with a grad transfer on one corner and a true freshman on the other.
But he thought they were playing as well as they could have been playing at this point in the season. And I mentioned those 4 explosive touchdowns a week ago against Clemson. Well, 2 of them were short yardage run situations that busted out. And so it wasn't like a cornerback getting beat.
3 receiver bunch to the far sideline. Jones wanted to throw it to the near sideline. Still has time to check it down to Najee Harris, who's down 2 shy of the first down. Here's Allison Williams.
And guys, Brian Kelly told me at the half they have to shore up their defense on the perimeter. And he said, look, I get it's a fine line, but they're not going right at us. We have to attack them. We can't be getting our feet set and being hesitant. We have to shoot our guns. And also, guys, really pleased with the physicality of his team throughout this game, especially on both lines of scrimmage. And he said that's going to be the key in the second half. On offense, can they continue to win at the line of scrimmage and run the ball?
Here's 3rd down, 1.5 yards. Not in field goal range for Will Reichard yet. A toss to Harris, and the first down.
Well, part of that Allison was talking about, Brian Kelly wanting to still run the football, they have to stay within striking distance in order for that to be effective for them. I mean, 21-7, if they can find a way to get a stop and not give Alabama points here, they can still think about running the football, play action, doing what they do. 28-7, a little different deal.
That six-yard run, Najee Harris over 100 yards rushing. Jones dumps it to Harris, who dropped the ball. There's no whistle. Now there is. Official from the near sideline came running in to blow it dead.
This is what I like about the way Mac Jones has developed as much as anything. So this is a play action call to take a shot down the field. It's not there, but he knows where his dump offs are. It's dropped by Najee Harris. But still, the decision to not force the ball downfield, just take the little dump off, because he knows those big plays will be around soon.
Harris stacked up. To me, Mac Jones, one of the best stories in college football this year. He was not a 4- or 5-star recruit, originally committed to Kentucky. And then Alabama invited him to come on a visit. And he, when he was offered, decided to go there, knowing that Tua Tagovailoa was there and Jalen Hurts.
Yep.
Were there, but he waited his turn, and he has had one of the great seasons in Alabama quarterback history.
You know, he was ready when his number was called. He has 4 years in the program. He had a lot of reps banked with Steve Sarkisian, and he was ready to step into the limelight this year.
Third down and 11, still probably not in field goal range. Jones.
That's a big stop for Notre Dame. That is the big stop for Notre Dame. The ball was deflected. It was caught by Jones for a loss of yardage.
Jason Adeola was the one who deflected it.
Five-man pressure. They're able to collapse the pocket. That was the center, Chris Owens, they were working on. The new center in there for Landon Dickerson, and they were able to get enough pressure to get the deflection and force fourth down.
Owens obviously has held up really well filling in for Dickerson. There's Charlie Scott, the brother of J.K. Scott, the former All-American punter at Alabama. Matt Salerno makes a fair catch. So they got the stop. Can the Irish move the ball again? They'll start from their own 10-yard line when we come back. This was just moments ago in New Orleans. Trevor Lawrence, the Clemson Tigers, arriving. Won the 2016 and 18 national championships. Hoping to take a step toward another tonight from the Sugar Bowl, 8 p.m. Eastern, as they take on Ohio State. That has become a rivalry in the last couple of years. Notre Dame from its own 10. Sebo Flemister in there getting his first carry. He's their power back. They got dropped for no gain by Will Anderson.
In that first half, Alabama did a really good job of neutralizing Michael Mayer, one of the leading receivers on this team. The freshman tight end, only one catch for 6 yards.
Interesting, Notre Dame went quickly that time, down by 2 scores. They're not going ball control. Nice catch by Ben Skoranek on an errant throw. And it'll be 3rd down and 4.
See, with Tremble out of the lineup, they do have other tight ends, but these wide receivers, Skoranek, Javon McKinley, are big enough to kind of use in some of those big sets. Skoranek is a very big receiver at 6'3", 225 pounds.
Early in the third quarter, but this feels big. 3rd down and 4. Alabama crowded the line, rushed 4. Kyren Williams shoved out of bounds. And he'll have the first down with a half yard to spare. Christian Harris pushed him out.
Well, so far, Tommy Rees is doing what he wanted to do, and that was feed Kyren Williams the football, both as a runner and a receiver. They free-released him on that one. Christian Harris was in coverage. He was able to get the ball across for the first down. Very valuable guy. You know, they thought before he won the number one running back spot that he might be their best slot receiver. They have a lot of faith in him catching the football.
Ian Book, the play action pass, and did well. They had him surrounded. He managed to make it a 3-yard gain.
This is not a Notre Dame offense that has dynamic players on the outside like Alabama does. They don't get a lot of separation. That's why they work to the tight end so much, and Ian Book makes a good decision there to run the football.
Well, Alabama must be doing a good job taking Michael Mayer away, because you would think he's a big target. They could take advantage of his size. They thought Alabama might be vulnerable in the middle of the defense. Book finds Michael Mayer for the first down out to the 35. Chopped down by DeMarco Helms. They call him Baby Gronk. Michael Mayer, similar size and skill set, and wears the same uniform number.
He's really good after the catch. I think that's what people get surprised by him. He's a big body, he's a big target, but he is really effective with yardage after the catch.
It was a 10-yard gain. Now some running room outside for Chris Tyree, and another excellent tackle, Patrick Surtain.
What a complete player he is, Sean. I mean, we know he's a cover guy, right? You don't go at him very much. We don't call his name very much in pass situations. He's running down on kickoff coverage and a sure tackle on the perimeter. I mean, this is textbook tackling in space.
And we rarely call his name because the opponents rarely throw in his direction.
I talked to Brian Kelly before the game. He said, we are not going to throw at Surtain. He's that good.
That's his dad, Patrick Surtain. Three-time Pro Bowler. Is a defensive back in the NFL. Played for Miami and Kansas City. Was also his son's high school coach for 2 years at American Heritage in South Florida. Book on the run. Threw it up for grabs, and it gets intercepted by Christian Harris. His first career interception for the sophomore from Baton Rouge.
Well, Christian Harris is going to be in coverage on Michael Mayer and does a beautiful job. He gets underneath, the ball is a little bit underthrown, and Christian Harris is there to get the interception.
Well, the message to Ian Book was, guys aren't going to be wide open, you still have to throw it, but not that time.
The Rose Bowl game presented by Capital One. What's in your wallet? And in part by Taco Bell's Nacho Fries.
Eighth meeting all time between these iconic football programs. Notre Dame has won five of the previous seven. Most recent 2012 championship game played in January of 2013, dominated by Alabama. They haven't dominated today, but it's never really felt like they're being seriously threatened either. Midway through the third quarter, they have the ball back after the first turnover of the game. Mac Jones, quick strike to John Metchie. John Metchie down the sideline. And Devontae Smith's sidekick takes them all the way to the 22-yard line. They come out attacking after the takeaway.
Well, they put Billingsley in motion. That spreads some things out a little bit. Then Metchie with the catch. Look at Devontae. Say, come on, follow me. Doing a little bit of everything. That's the second time we've seen him blocking on the perimeter, working on McLeod, the corner. Nick Saban said there is nobody that has impacts our football team more than Devontae Smith in the way he practices, plays, works.
We could have figured that out.
Yeah.
40-yard play to Metchie, 30 after the catch. Flag thrown, couple flags thrown, rare flags. Incomplete pass for Najee Harris with Maris Leofau in coverage. This will be the first penalty assessed against either team today. John O'Neill out of the Big Ten and his crew have done a great job.
Holding, offense number 79, 10 yards from the previous spot. Repeat first down.
Chris Owens, fifth year senior from a couple of miles away. Played at Lamar High School here in Arlington, about 2 miles from AT&T Stadium.
The Lamar Vikings, couple of my buddies.
Now you're just showing off. Matt Sine.
Matt Sine, Bobby Sine, Chris Sine, who was also an offensive lineman at Alabama from Arlington Lamar.
There probably aren't that many signs between here and the high school. Only 2 miles. Well, you're talking with Matt Austin, our referee. You made
Please
a great point at the half, Matt.
To 6 minutes, 48
seconds. We've now had one turnover. That was the first penalty. And to you and the officiating crew, that's probably not a surprise.
No, it's really not. These games are just a joy to officiate because both teams are so well coached. They don't do silly things. They don't false start. They don't offside, jump off sides. And they don't mess around after the ball's dead. They don't hit each other and get up swinging and pushing each other. It's just a joy to officiate when the teams play like this.
First and 20 now, back at the 32. Play action pass. Jones just flipped it to Najee Harris, trying to stiff arm Drew White. And Harris out of bounds. He has become their all-time leading rusher. In fact, became their all-time leading rusher in the SEC title game when he moved past Sean Alexander and Derrick Henry.
His decision to come back this year has really paid off. Todd McShay talked about how he's climbed the charts, but he's just become a better, more complete running back in every aspect.
They give it to him. He bounced it to the left. And they knock him down at the 16. They need to make the 12 here on third down. Another stop for Drew White.
And Najee, to me, some of the difference is obviously in the passing game. He's great in pass protection. He's gotten better covering or catching the football in space. But what I love is he's not dancing around. He's a big back, and he's acting like a big back this year.
And that was the message the coaches gave to him before the season started. If you want to get better, don't dance and bounce. Take what the play gives you. Mac Jones on third and four. He's going to take off running and slide down with the first down at the 7.
Well, he's not used to running, and he's obviously not used to sliding, but that was a good decision to do both. He had trips receivers to the right. Notre Dame had him covered. Ooh. And that was awkward at best.
You can hurt yourself.
Yeah, but effective. A first down on a good decision by Mac Jones. 19 of 22 throwing the football. He doesn't force things. He doesn't put the ball in harm's way.
Design roll to the right on first and goal, and he throws to the pylon, and it is caught for another touchdown by Devontae Smith.
This is just beautiful timing and accuracy. You throw this football to the front pylon. Devontae Smith is going to push the route into the end zone, and he's expecting the football right at the front pylon. Both feet in, only needs one. But the timing and the accuracy on the move by Mac Jones, spectacular.
His fourth touchdown pass, the third caught by Devontae Smith. And the view from the AT&T 5G pylon cam. It's Devontae's seventh game this year with 100 plus receiving yards and at least 2 touchdown receptions. The only other player who's done that in FBS football since 2000 is Michael Crabtree at Texas Tech back in 2007. Adding to his Alabama single season record, and is now tied the SEC mark set last year by Ja'Marr Chase. The 86th annual Heisman Trophy ceremony presented by Nissan comes your way virtually on Tuesday, January 5th, 7 p.m. on ESPN and the app. Live from the ESPN studios in Bristol, Connecticut. Here in the home of the Dallas Cowboys, Roger Staubach, of course, the Heisman Trophy winner. The 4 finalists are Mac Jones, Devontae Smith, Trevor Lawrence, Clemson, and Florida's Kyle Trask. And here's a fair catch by Chris Tyree off the Will Reichard kickoff.
Well, Devontae Smith having another outstanding game, and the impact and effect he has on the game. Obviously, when he catches the football, if you don't get him on the ground, he's going to make you pay. But he also opens things up for his teammates. He draws double coverage. Billingsley, this was the second touchdown, wide open to the back of the end zone, all because of the attention paid to Devontae Smith. Then the beautiful throw and catch for the third touchdown. His impact is being felt big time.
And his 3 touchdown catches ties the Rose Bowl record. It's been done twice previously. I'll give you those details in a moment. First, it's first and 10. With five to go in the third quarter. Ben Skoranek out of bounds at the 30-yard line. There are the four Heisman Trophy finalists. And of course, Najee Harris finished fifth.
Yeah.
Last time one school had three of the top five in the voting was Army back in the mid 40s. But who do you like? Who do you think is going to win?
I think Devontae's going to win. You know, I think if Trevor Lawrence hadn't missed two games, I think it would have been hard for him not to win it. But I think Devontae's going to win.
Book on the run. Throws it away.
It's a late hit flag. This is going to be a 15-yard penalty on Alabama after the play. Ian Book just throwing the ball away. Good coverage down the field.
I blame Matt Austin. Just as he said, they don't hit anybody
personal
after
foul.
The play.
Roughing the passer. Defense number 47. 15 yards from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
I think it was the throw down at the end. It wasn't so much the hit as the fact that he pushed him down with a little force at the end of the play.
Byron Young,
yep.
Sophomore from Laurel, Mississippi.
And that's a big penalty for Notre Dame because they, you know, again, they are hanging on by a thread right now. Their offense needs to possess the football, put some more points on the board, and bring this back to a two-score game if they can.
Second penalty against Alabama for a total of 25 yards. Tyron Williams, the running back.
Avery Davis has not done anything either. He's a guy in the slot that has to make some plays.
There's the four-man rush, but they get to Book, who can't unload it. With Christian Barmore draped all over him, a big loss back to the 30-yard line.
Well, Barmore with just a bull rush in between the right guard and the center. He is an elite pass rusher, and watch him come right in this gap. And when this pressure comes inside, I don't care how good of an escape artist you are as a quarterback, it's difficult. And Barmore not only gets him on the ground, puts the full weight of his body on top of him, too.
It's the first sack of the game for either team. Talked about how outstanding these offensive lines are. Seventh of the year for Barmore. Tying him with his teammate Will Anderson for the SEC lead.
For an injured offensive player.
And it's Ian Book.
Full media timeout.
Who has taken almost all of the snaps at quarterback this season for Notre Dame.
You can see the end of this play. It looked like Ian Book landed on the football, went into the tent. Brian Kelly not happy with his veteran offensive line, giving up the first sack of the game. But for Alabama now, 19 sacks in their last four ball games.
They were hard to come by early in the season for Bama. So Drew Pine is the new quarterback, appearing in just his fourth game of the season. They started him with a handoff to Kyron Williams. True freshman from New Canaan, Connecticut. Has thrown two passes all season, both in the South Florida game. Mop-up time, they won that one 52-0. He went 1 for 2 for 5 yards. Rushed once for 4 yards.
You got to imagine he has a scaled down playbook. You don't know how long Ian Book is going to be out.
Highly recruited player, 4-star recruit. And they give him a play action pass and he's on target. For Ben Skoranek, so no matter what happens from here on, Drew Pine can say he completed a pass in the Rose Bowl, but it's way short of the line to make, and Brian Kelly sends on the punt team on fourth down and 16 after that 7-yard completion. And Devontae Smith back deep. Jay Bramlett to punt. Mentioned he's from Tuscaloosa, Alabama. His dad, Mike, played high school football with Clemson's coach Dabo Sweeney. This one is returnable for Devontae Smith. And he got tripped up at the 30. Well, he might have been off to the races. 21-yard return. Well, as I mentioned, last year, Alabama, with its history, thought perhaps they'd return for the sixth straight year to the college football playoff. But LSU, Joe Burrow, and others said nope. They wound up 11-2 with a bowl win over Michigan, the Citrus Bowl. But this year, taking no chances. They've steamrolled the competition. Number one without any question, and reinforcing that today. Up by 21 with 2 minutes to go in the third quarter. Miller Forrestall's had a nice day. Seems like he's been there forever. A lot of injuries throughout the years, including last year, a damaged voice box, which would be, I think, just about the worst thing that could happen.
For you, especially,
watching,
right?
You wouldn't think that would be so bad. But he had difficulty speaking.
Miller Forrestall, you talk about high school teammates. Miller Forrestall, a high school teammate of Clemson quarterback Trevor Lawrence. In fact, he was the quarterback before Trevor Lawrence arrived as an eighth grader, and then he was a tight end.
He was smart enough to know he wasn't going to play Cartersville, Georgia. After Trevor Lawrence arrived, we'll see Trevor and the Clemson Tigers in the Sugar Bowl coming up next against Ohio State. Harris ahead for very little.
You know, Sean, we've been blessed to be able to do the playoffs ever since they started. And last year we watched that LSU offense and we thought, I mean, this is as good an offense as we've ever seen in college football, right? And we saw him in the playoffs, just go right through the playoffs. And this offense Nick Saban's got out here right now with his big three, the numbers are shockingly very similar when you look at this year's Alabama and last year's LSU team.
The teams are similar as well. Slade Bolden the catch in Irish territory at the 44. Quarterback who seemingly came out of nowhere to have a historic season. A great wide receiver, as LSU had a couple of those last year. Outstanding veteran offensive line, the running back who could hurt your running and catching.
Very, very similar makeup of the team. The defenses both had their struggles against Ole Miss that we saw, but got better as the season went on. And, you know, playing their best football right now.
They've slowed down the tempo as the Crimson Tide with the big lead here. Here's an all out blitz, and Jones smartly just fired it at the feet of Harris. And smartly is not a surprise either. Mac Jones graduated from Alabama with an undergraduate degree in 2.5 years and a perfect 4.0 GPA in business communications. And last month he received his master's degree in sports hospitality.
Impressive kid. I mean, and very goal oriented, very driven, very focused, very serious minded guy.
Very competitive, grew up in Jacksonville, a big fan of Tim Tebow. Idolized Tim, had a chance to meet him as a young boy. Harris stopped by Drew White, and that'll take us to the fourth quarter. Alabama, after just 1 year out of the college football playoff, has returned with authority, leading Notre Dame 28-7 as we head to the fourth quarter in the Rose Bowl game presented by Capital One. Teams are on the field and warming up at the Sugar Bowl in New Orleans, site of today's second college football playoff semifinal. Travis Etienne and Clemson getting ready for Ohio State. All-time leading rusher in ACC history, Travis Etienne. Third down and 8 for Alabama as we go to the fourth quarter here at the Rose Bowl game. Tide leading by 21, and Najee Harris picks up the first down inside the 30, taken down by Kyle Hamilton.
See, again, that is, as Landon Dickerson watches his offensive line mates, that's the problem for Notre Dame. That time they said, we're going to play coverage, 3rd and 8. They had 2 safeties deep. They were going to be able to bring safety help over the top of Devontae Smith. Steve Sarkisian calls a run. The numbers favor the run for Alabama, that outstanding offensive line, even without Landon Dickerson. And they pick up a 3rd and 8, running a basic run play.
Notre Dame showing blitz. Faked it to Harris and tried to throw the quick slant to Devontae Smith, and it was batted out of the air. Shane Simon, the linebacker, junior from West Orange, New Jersey.
Mac Jones has had good success on these RPOs. That time Simon kind of stayed right in the throwing lane with eyes on the quarterback. That's why he was able to get that right hand up and get the deflection.
And good thing for Notre Dame he did. You could see how far behind Devontae Smith, Nick McLeod was. That might have been touchdown number four for Smith.
This is an area of the field where Devontae likes to run double moves also.
Brian Robinson, a senior, also just graduated last month. A very capable backup to Najee Harris.
Alabama very content to run clock, take their time getting the plays called, take their time getting to the line of scrimmage.
Reckon Book looks like he's ready to return when they get the ball back.
Well, the last third and eight, it was a running play. See what Steve Sarkisian calls now, starting out of an empty backfield. Probably not a quarterback run.
I think they give Mac Jones a huge gap through the middle of that defense to almost entice him to run. Billingsley the catch. And a nice tackle by Kyle Hamilton to drop him short of the first down.
Sean, Ian Book spent an extended amount of time in the injury tent. He was sitting on the edge of the table. It appeared that athletic trainers were looking at something with his upper body, but he came running out, jumped on the phone with offensive coordinator Tommy Reese, and has been thrown around on the sideline ever since, so he appears good to go.
There's Will Reichert with the first field goal attempt of the day for Alabama. Sophomore from Hoover, Alabama, has had, wait till he kicks it, a perfect season.
And that hasn't always been the case for Alabama under Nick Saban. They've been great in so many aspects of the game, but kicking and kicking field goals has not always been the case.
He's made all 89 kicks he's tried this season, including 13 for 13 in field goals. That one good from 41. The National Championship Trophy presented by Dr. Pepper. We'll be there at Hard Rock Stadium, Miami, on January 11th for the College Football Playoff National Championship game. Looking like it'll be Alabama against the winner of the Sugar Bowl to come next. Clemson and Ohio State right after we're finished here in Arlington. And how about this big lead? That's Patrick Surtain and Josh Jobe. They're two starting cornerbacks about to run down on kickoff coverage. Chris Tyree makes a fair catch on the Will Reichert kickoff. Todd McShay, what do you like about Patrick Surtain? I know you have him as a top 10 pick in the next draft.
Yeah, I think he could be a top 5 pick. He's the first defensive back that's going to get drafted. And you see here, we never say his name because no one wants to throw against him. And he just blankets receivers. He actually, tonight, he's been baiting Ian Book the whole night to throw towards him. And Ian Book's been smart enough to not to throw in his direction.
Probably be the winner of the Thorpe Award as the best defensive back in the country. High throw. Javon McKinley managed to take it in with Josh Jobe in coverage.
Penalty flag thrown in the middle of the field.
First actually, catch for McKinley if it stands.
Yeah, I think it's going to stand. I think it's going to be a defensive holding on the inside on Michael Mayer.
Holding.
So the catch will stand.
Defense number 32. That penalty is declined. The result of the play is a first down.
See, that's the only way you're going to complete balls on the perimeter against these corners. You're not going to have separation. It's tight coverage. And you got to throw the ball up and hope those guys use their big bodies to go up and high point a catch, and that's exactly what McKinley did there.
Book on target to Skowronek. The catch by McKinley is first for 18 yards. He's one of those guys for Notre Dame, Todd. Either he has a 100-yard game, he had four of them this year, or you don't even notice him. He had 700 yards receiving total, and four of those were in 100-yard games.
He's a graduate. It's his last year. Brian Kelly told us when we had them early, and this is really his first year under the bright lights, his first time being a marquee player, and he's had his moments for sure.
They seem to come in bunches. Here's Kyren Williams bouncing off hits, first down to the 42-yard line. We're under 12 minutes to go in this Rose Bowl game. Kyren. And now Kyren Williams is going to limp off.
He's run hard today. I mean, you know, again, he only had 50 yards against Clemson a week ago, only 64 yards rushing, but he's running with energy, he's running with strength, and four catches out of the backfield as well.
Cook, given plenty of time that time, has Michael Mayer. He spun down at the 35-yard line by Dylan Moses.
Actually, I cheated him. He has seven catches, not four.
Second down and three.
Again, Alabama's done a really good job of neutralizing Avery Davis, the slot receiver. He's had some big plays for them,
especially in that win against Clemson. Swing pass to Chris Tyree for a first down. Just one target today for Avery Davis. That was the biggest win of Ian Book's tenure as starting quarterback. I think of the Brian Kelly era, certainly one of them. The regular season win against Clemson in a classic double overtime game in South Bend. They had to go 91 yards at the end of regulation to tie it. Davis had two huge catches. But not a factor today. Targeted once, not a completion. Unblocked blitzer. Jordan Battlin get there, and Book got it off to Michael Mayer. And Notre Dame is on the move with 10.5 to go in the fourth, down 24.
Really nice job by Ian Book, just retreating enough to get rid of the football. And Michael Mayer beats Dylan Moses in coverage. And that's a nice completion for a first down. Quarterback knew the blitz was coming, just retreated enough to give himself a chance to make the throw.
18-yard gain. Books 18 of 22 for 160. And an interception. Five-man rush. They flushed Book. He has a wide open Michael Mayer in the end zone, but there is a flag down. It's a Notre Dame touchdown if it stands.
This is going to be a penalty against Notre Dame. I think an illegal shift or an illegal motion is going to wipe this one out.
Illegal shift. Offense numbers 85 and 25. 5-yard penalty, still first down.
Well, Tyree is out as a wide receiver. He never really gets set. He's kind of bouncing around. 85 is Takis, the tight end inside. And they just didn't get set in a legal position.
First assessed penalty against the Irish today. One penalty for 5 yards, only one turnover. They played very clean football, but they're down by 24. And running out of time. They bring pressure again. Book the short throw to Michael Mayer, who didn't even want to play football in high school. He wanted to be a basketball player. His dad, Andy, actually called the freshman football coach at Covington Catholic. Coach Edgerton said, could you encourage Michael to play football? So he played reluctantly. They wound up, when he made it to the varsity the next year, going 44-1. He was a dominant two-way player. Very intense football player. Coaches described him as ultra serious. Baby Gronk becoming a factor here late. Book could not get away. Byron Young swung him down.
It's a really good play by Byron Young because he was coming on an inside stunt, but he had eyes on the quarterback. He wasn't going to get there for a sack, but he was able to shed the block and make the tackle for a very short yardage gain by Ian Book.
Third down and 10. Nice drive, but they're taking a lot of time, nearly 4 minutes on this possession, and the throw too high for Ben Skoranek. Josh Jobe in coverage. And what do you do here on fourth and 10? You're in short field goal range, but Brian Kelly's going to leave the offense out there.
Yeah, go for a touchdown here. Field goal is not going to help you at this point. At the end of the half, you know, that's a different situation. Now it's, yeah, score a touchdown. And that ball just kind of sailed on Ian Book. He had Skoranek. He was open enough to make a completion. The ball took off on Ian Book.
With Kyron Williams, their outstanding running back on the sideline. Fourth down and 10. Book gets it off short of Avery Davis, who couldn't make the catch. With Brian Branch right behind him, and Alabama will take over on downs.
Wondering if this ball got deflected a little bit at the line of scrimmage. The rusher, Jalen Moody, number 42, got a hand up. I don't know if he got a hand on the football or not. Take a look and see if number 42, Moody, gets his right hand up. The ball kind of dies at the receiver, and Notre Dame turns the ball over on downs.
The Rose Bowl game presented by Capital One. What's in your wallet? And in part by AT&T 5G and Ford. We're all in this together. Let's finish strong.
Well, the only other time the Rose Bowl game was moved out of the Rose Bowl Stadium, 1942, shortly after the bombings in Pearl Harbor. They weren't allowed to have major events on the West Coast, so Oregon State and Duke played it. Duke and Durham, game won by Oregon State. Wallace Wade Stadium, named for the Hall of Fame Alabama coach. John Metchie weaved his way near a first down. Looks like they're going to give it to him. And we fully expect the Rose Bowl will be right back where it belongs next year in Pasadena. Commend the Rose Bowl folks. Being able to move it in short notice, and also the people here affiliated with the Cotton Bowl, Jerry Jones and the Dallas Cowboys. That decision was made only days ago. Brian Robinson, the running back. Mac Jones still at quarterback. Devontae Smith at wide receiver. Robinson about a yard and a half. Unfortunately, this is nothing new in the college football playoff. This is the seventh year. So in the first 6 years, there have been 12 semifinal games played. Nine of them decided by double figures, including, you know, last year, LSU beat Oklahoma by 34. Back in 16, Alabama here shut out Michigan State 38-0. Clemson in 17 had a 31-0 win over Ohio State. There have been a lot of blowouts in the semifinal round.
Well, last year's game between Ohio State and Clemson was a heck of a ball game. Went down to the wire.
And let's hope
we're hoping that it is tonight as well in the Sugar Bowl.
More than midway through the fourth quarter now. Mac Jones off the hands of Devontae Smith. There goes the Heisman.
Yeah. Well, that is a rarity, because coming into the game, he had been targeted 123 times, according to Pro Football Focus, and only two drops. That makes number three.
Foul, roughing the passer. Defense number 19. 15 yards from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
Justin Adamiola, twin brother of Jason Adamiola, who had a big batted pass out of the air earlier, as big as it can be in a 24-point game.
Well, we saw one against Ian Book on the sideline, just because he pushed him to the ground, and that time I think just finishing that tackle is what drew the flag. It seems a little nitpicky, but
well, the about officials need some airtime now. There's only four penalties in the game, two on each team. Oop, looked like the left side of the line was moving. They still have the starters in there as well.
You know, we talk so much, and rightfully so, about the big three.
Offense number 70, 5-yard penalty, still first down.
You know, all three finish in the top five voting for the Heisman Trophy. Incredible individual seasons, but it all starts with this group up front. And both these offensive lines, two of the three offensive lines up for the Joe Moore Award to the best unit, Texas A&M, the other group. But this group playing tonight without their leader and heart and soul, Landon Dickerson, another impressive performance by this Alabama front line.
Entering the year, Ekior was the only new starter. Toss to Brian Robinson, the only offensive lineman they had replaced the last year was Jedrick Wills, big replacement. Yeah. He was a top 10 pick in the NFL by the Cleveland Browns.
Well, they moved Evan Neal, who was a right guard, out to right tackle, and that's why Ekior slipped into right guard. Deontay Brown, the left guard, and it is an impressive group. Bunch of guys that are going to be playing on Sundays.
Including Alex Leatherwood, enormous left tackle, 6'6", 312. He thought about going to the NFL at the end of last year, came back to win a championship. First team All-American. And he shared the best offensive lineman, the Jacobs Blocking Trophy, in the SEC with his center, Landon Dickerson. Xavier Williams the catch. Apparently didn't go out of bounds. Maximized his air time, spinning like a top. And Leatherwood, I don't know where he would have been drafted last year, but I would imagine we'll ask Todd McShay in a moment about his prospects. He's out of Pensacola, Florida. His high school coach was
Charlie Ward.
Charlie Ward.
Right. Nick Saban was frustrated with me because he thought I had him too high, and he wanted him to come back. And you know what? He was right, as usual.
And but where do you have him now, Alex Leatherwood?
I have him as a third-round pick. And he got from the advisory committee a go-back-to-school. If it's not the first or second round, it's go-back-to-school.
That was last year. Here comes a blitz at Mac Jones. But where did you have him last year?
Had him in the second.
Oh, too high, apparently.
Too high, yep. I had to go back and study the tape. And it's a late flag here.
I think it's going to be intentional grounding. Yep.
Offense number 10. Loss it down at the spot of the foul. Fourth down.
Yeah, Mac Jones had not left the tackle box. Made a good decision to get rid of the football, but threw the ball out of bounds from the tackle box, and that's what drew the flag.
Here's Charlie Scott to punt. Matt Salerno back deep. Scott a transfer from the Air Force Academy. He was their primary punter the last 3 years. Got approval from the military to defer his service for 1 year, so he could be a grad transfer. And here come flags for the shove at the end of that play. A fair catch made by Matt Salerno. Devontae Smith was there. And Nick Saban is gesturing that he thinks Smith got shoved into Salerno.
He did a little bit. I don't think it needed a flag, period. There's the shove by Griffith, the safety, and then another one by Tyree.
There is no foul or personal foul.
That's
the
good.
The contact was a result of the block.
That's good.
Time
good
out.
Officiating.
With 5:32 to go, Alabama heading to Miami for the title game. Aerial coverage provided by Goodyear to reach the end zone. All you need is drive, Goodyear more driven. Chilly night outside. It's in the 30s here in Dallas. Notre Dame back on offense. But down by 24 with 5:32 to go. Ian Book in his last game as Notre Dame quarterback. If they don't rally dramatically. Chris Tyree pulled down by Jalen Moody, backup linebacker. His 15th tackle of the year.
Again, remember this Notre Dame offense now playing without the services of one of their best tight ends. Tommy Tremble has been out most of the game, and then Kyron Williams has not come back either.
Book rifled one across the middle.
Boy, did he take
a shot. First down. Lawrence Keyes the catch. His first of the game, just the sixth by a Notre Dame wide receiver, just his fifth of the year. He had concussion issues earlier in the season. Chris Allen blasted Book.
Yeah, he really got into him. You show the courage right there of Ian Book to stay in there and deliver the football on target.
Tyree, a gain of 3 to the 46, and we're ticking down to 4.5 minutes to go. Well, it's been quite a career at Notre Dame for Ian Book. Wasn't a top recruit, 3-star recruit out of the Sacramento, California area, originally headed to Washington State. Boise State had showed some interest. Mike Sanford was an assistant there. They kept in touch when Sanford went to Notre Dame. They brought Ian in for a visit, and he committed right away. He's under pressure and dropped from behind by DeMarco Helms.
DeMarco Helms had a full head of steam. He was coming on a safety blitz, and he never slowed down. Ian Book feels the pressure coming, but Helms has got a full head of steam, and he's able to chase down Book from behind and get him on the ground.
And primarily a special teams player, but he has really become a factor on their defense as well. Third down and 8. 3 sacks for Alabama. None for Notre Dame. And Book's pass goes over the head of Mayer, with Helms bringing the heat on Book again.
Well, right now, Alabama kind of pinning their ears back on their pass rush, bringing extra bodies. Ian Book not able to step into that one. Clear overthrow on third down. And Brian Kelly's looking like he may punt the football here.
Well, he's yelling punt. So here's Bramblett. Mentioned he's from Tuscaloosa. His dad played high school football in Pelham in Alabama with Dabo Sweeney. Dabo's played against Notre Dame. He didn't know that was his old buddy Mike Bramblett's son. Mike Bramblett reached out to Dabo before the ACC title game. Said, would you take a picture with my son on the field? Who's your son? He's the Notre Dame punter. You've already played him once this year. They took a nice picture. 3.5 to go in Arlington. There's Justin Fields, the Ohio State quarterback, arriving at the Sugar Bowl for the second semifinal against the Clemson Tigers. Heartbreaking loss a year ago. They had a lead. Felt like they didn't get the good end of some calls in that one as well. Winner of that one likely to play Alabama for the national title. Matter of fact, ESPN News is projecting the Crimson Tide, the winner, and they'll be in Miami on January 11th for the national championship game.
After the timeout, Brian Kelly electing to go for it now on fourth down.
And Ian Book's on target. Avery Davis, his first catch. The senior, of course, Notre Dame lists them by their academic class instead of their football eligibility.
Well, those are the routes that Ian Book said that were kind of his favorite routes this week. The deep ends, the over routes, because they thought the place to attack was on the interior. This is tough here.
Yeah, up for grabs for Skoranek, trying to throw a jump ball and take advantage of his height. And Patrick Surtain there, he's just one of those guys who takes away half the field. They don't even try to throw at him, Notre Dame and everybody else.
He's in perfect position again, and if he comes down in bounds, it's an interception. It's a bigger receiver. It doesn't matter. Patrick Surtain has the strength.
Sportsmanlike conduct. Head coach Alabama. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
Patrick Surtain's
first unsportsmanlike conduct foul.
Dad can't believe it. It's not out of character for Nick to be a little agitated, even with a big lead. Constantly coaching and teaching. So it's first and 10. Notre Dame at the 25-yard line. Helms came in another blitz, and McKinley swung down by Jordan Battle. Second down, under 3 minutes to go. You know, we talked to Pete Golding, the defense coordinator, about Patrick Surtain, the younger. He said he talked about his poise and nothing phases him.
Yeah.
And he's so technically sound. I said, well, do you think part of that's growing up around his dad? He said, yeah, that probably helped a lot.
Well, Patrick told us his dad started working fundamentals with him at age 5. So, yeah, I think so.
Michael Mayer, the catch. Patrick Surtain still talks to his dad every week before the games. Dad gives him a pep talk. They say a pregame prayer. And I think this says a lot about the dad. The prayer every week is the same. Win, lose, or draw, we're here for you. We are your number one fans, and we love you.
Surtain is one of the most technically sound corners I've ever evaluated. Almost 20 years of doing this in terms of press coverage and knowing when to open up and turn.
Book on first and 10. Throws it away. Well, Nick Saban would like you to say he's a fourth round pick, Tom, just in case you influence his decision.
Did you call me and yell at me again?
He's a junior, one of the six first team All-Americans on this Alabama team. The other five are all on the offense.
I have him at number 7 overall in the class, in the first defensive back. And you can see tonight exactly why.
Yeah, and there's no reason for him to stay. As much as the Bama fans would like him to, he is ready to go. Kyren Williams back in the game, left for a while. Thankfully not injured seriously enough to prevent his return. He's to the 8-yard line. 2 minutes to go. Well, we mentioned earlier, Alabama the biggest favorite in the history of the college football playoff in year 7. 19.5 points, they lead by 24. With 1:43 to go. Book caught by Mayer, who's banged down at the 1. Josh Job who delivered the hit. Dylan Moses there as well. First and goal, 1.5 minutes to go. Another long drive for the Irish. Ian Book, looks like he was juggling the snap a little bit. Yeah. He didn't get there.
Yeah, I think you run this with Kyren Williams again like you did earlier when you were inside the 1-yard line trying to get a push up front.
One minute to go. Book the fake and he takes it in himself for the Notre Dame touchdown. But there is a flag on the play.
Offside defense number 28. That penalty is declined. Result of the play is a touchdown.
Josh Job, the defensive back. Ian Book, the rushing touchdown.
Well, they fake to Kyren Williams. It holds the Alabama defense. You can see Dylan Moses, number 32, fooled by the fake. And for Ian Book, his 9th rushing touchdown of the season.
17th of his career, tying with Rick Meyer for 3rd most by a Notre Dame quarterback. Sean Kizer at 18, and Tony Rice, the all-time record holder, with 23. Extra point good for Jonathan Doerr. So no surprise, if you've watched Ian Book play, and we have a lot these last few years, that he would battle all the way to the end. A terrific competitor. We'll see if he gets a shot at the next level.
He's voted 2-time captain, which means a whole lot to him. I thought he said something really interesting to us on our Zoom call the other day. He says, I want to be the kind of teammate that or guy that my teammates can count on, both in football and in life. You know, and I think so being a captain and being that respected is very, very important to him.
McShay and I are hoping that you strive for that too as we go forward into the new year. Potential onside kick coming. There is one streak, and we talked about Notre Dame struggling to defend, but Alabama has scored 35 points or more in 24 straight games. Not only is that the longest active streak in the country, it's the all-time record in FBS football. They have 31 right now.
In the air.
Oh, Devontae Smith couldn't come up with the onside kick. And the Irish have it at the 47-yard line. Jeremiah Owusu-Koramoah, perhaps playing in his last game for Notre Dame, the conference defensive player of the year in the ACC, with the recovery.
Well, you think this is the guy you want to try to field it if you're Alabama. Devontae Smith not able to catch it cleanly, and Owusu-Koramoah right there.
The ball was touched by the receiving team, then recovered by the kicking team. Notre Dame's ball, 1st and 10. Please adjust the game clock to 56 seconds.
Well,
correction.
We...
correction, 54 seconds on the game clock.
We had deemed Devontae Smith the offensive player of the game. We should stay with that.
Yeah.
3 touchdown
that was
catches.
A special teams play.
Tying the Rose Bowl record. Braylon Edwards had 3 for Michigan against Texas in a great Rose Bowl in 2005. And Deontay Burnett for USC three from Sam Darnold against your alma mater in 2017. Book throws low, trying to feed it through to Ben Skoranek. Well, who do you like in the game coming up next? Clemson and Ohio State.
You know, it's so hard for me to actually know because I just have not seen Ohio State enough. I mean, obviously, they didn't play as many games and we didn't have them at all. I do think Clemson is playing very well right now. I think they were very in sync against this Notre Dame team in the ACC championship game. I think Trevor Lawrence is at the top of his game right now. I think getting Skalski and Tyler Davis back on defense solidifies their defense. I think Clemson's going to win the football game. But Justin Fields had a nice ball game last year. If his thumb is good and he's good to go, he can make a lot of things happen for that Buckeye offense as well.
As you said, they met last year. It's really becoming a little bit of a contentious rivalry. Josh Jobe breaks up a pass and gets flagged for it. The Bama fans and sideline hate it. Javon McKinley, the intended receiver.
Pass interference. Defense number 28. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
Well, it looked like there was a lot of contact, but they've been letting them play for most of the game. There's the grab also. I don't know, I think he pulled him with his right hand.
Correction, the ball be placed at the spot of the foul. First down.
Mac Jones didn't like it. What does Matt Austin think? I know your wife would like you to get a little more airtime tonight. Mr. Austin, what do you think?
I think that was a good call. He had his inside arm locked and was pulling it down pretty good. Would have forced him to go up for a one-handed catch, so that was a good call.
All right. You've made your minimum number of appearances now, so the check will be coming. Ian Book pressured by Jalen Moody and threw it away.
There's no foul for intentional grounding. Quarterback was out.
Here's the Capital One rewarding performance.
Well, it's Mac Jones and the chemistry and connection he has with Devontae Smith. They are on the same page completely. It's been that way all year. It was that way again tonight. They connected for three touchdowns. The timing and the trust between these two guys is pretty fun to watch.
Final 15 seconds and some movement. Looked like it was Liam Eichenberg playing in his last game, and what a career he's had at Notre Dame.
False start. Offense number 74. 5-yard penalty. Still second down. There's no opportunity for a 10-second runoff as the game clock was not running at the time.
38th straight start for Eichenberg out of a powerhouse high school program, St. Ignatius in Cleveland. Second team All-American this year. He'll be on his way to the NFL. Yep. Brian Kelly said, we need to get better along the lines. They've done it in recruiting.
Yep.
Since that loss to Alabama 8 years ago, they've had four offensive linemen drafted in the first round since 2014, most in the country.
Well, 357 yards of total offense for Notre Dame. I know that the game has never really been in question, but that's a lot more than they had a week ago against Clemson. Only 262 yards of offense against the Tigers last week in the ACC championship game.
Brian Kelly said we're better. They are better, but they're contending with a juggernaut here today. Alabama clearly will be the favorite in the championship game regardless of the opponent. Ian Book, one last rumble down the field. Or perhaps another as they stop the clock with 1 second left.
We have time for one more throw to the end zone here for Ian Book.
Notre Dame has gotten bigger and stronger and more physical, but they need more speed on the perimeter. Really on both sides of the ball.
Timeout, Notre Dame.
Yeah. Notre Dame calls a timeout. Bama fans booing. They want to get the party started. Socially distanced and masked, of course. Trevor Lawrence getting ready. What is almost certainly his either last or second to last college football game. If they win, he'll play one more, but then he's likely to be a Jacksonville Jaguar. Uh-huh.
I would not bet against this guy.
Yeah, he's pretty special.
He is. He will be the first overall pick by the Jaguars. If the Jets were picking at number one, they would have taken him too.
Devontae Smith, 3 touchdown receptions, by the way, not just tying the Rose Bowl record. They are an Alabama bowl game record for any bowl. 6 times previously, the receiver had 2 touchdown catches. And I think before we see him again in Miami in 11 days, he's going to collect the Heisman Trophy.
Yep, I think so too.
First wide receiver to do it since Desmond Howard, if in fact he does win it. Blitz, book. It's almost as if Alabama saying, okay, you want to call a timeout, run one more play, we're going to try to blast you. It was intended for Avery Davis, and it brings an end to this Rose Bowl game presented by Capital One. Devontae Smith, 7 catches, 130 yards, and 3 touchdowns. And by his standards lately, that's been a quiet night. He averaged 144 yards receiving over the previous 6 games. He'll need 10 yards to become the all-time leader in SEC receiving yardage. He's 10 behind Jordan Matthews of Vanderbilt, who holds that record. So they're on their way to the national championship for the 5th time in 7 years of the college football playoff.
You wonder if Nick is taking his team home right now, if they're going to stay here in Texas and watch the game, or if they're going to go home and just watch it on film tomorrow.
They treated this like a business trip. They just came here yesterday like it was your regular in-season away game. Nick Saban let his players go home for Christmas, said he didn't have the heart to tell them they couldn't do it. They came back. Thankfully, no positive COVID tests. Notre Dame stayed on campus. Brian Kelly was Santa Claus. Here's Allison Williams.
Thank you very much, Sean. Here with head coach Nick Saban. Coach, this was a team victory, and you led from start to finish. What stood out to you about the way your team was able to control this game?
Well, you know, I was really proud of our players. They worked hard. You know, we didn't come here to finish here, so I was really proud of the way we came out and played. We didn't finish the game like we'd like. You know, we'd like to take the air out of it on offense. I've always got something that I'm complaining about. It's a great team win. You know, we played well on special teams. The offense did a good job of controlling the tempo of the game. And defensively, we got enough stops to be able to get off the field when we needed to. So it was a great team win. And these guys have really earned the opportunity to play in the national championship game. So we'll see what we can do with it.
You mentioned your defense. And Notre Dame presented some different challenges for your team. What was the key to holding them to just the 14 points?
Well, I think that we played really good team defense. We got some stops when we needed to. We controlled the quarterback about as well as you can do it. He still got out of there a couple times, but we tried to make him run sideways, and we did. We had success when he was able to step up. We didn't have as much success, so you know, there's a lot of things that goes into playing winning football, and a lot of guys have to do their job to do it.
And one of those guys was Devontae Smith. How do you begin to describe the impact he has on this game?
Well, he does a great job. He's a talented guy. He's a hard worker. I mean, he does everything exactly right. He has a great understanding of what he needs to do to be able to make plays, and he makes them every chance he gets. So we're very fortunate to have him, and he's had a great year.
Coach Saban, thank you so much. Congratulations.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
One win away now from his 7th national title as a head coach. It would be his 6th at Alabama if they can defeat Clemson or Ohio State in the national championship game. The trophy ceremony coming away shortly. We'll have the naming of the offensive and defensive players of the game here at the Rose Bowl game presented by Capital One. Another record-setting day for Devontae Smith. Mentioned the 3 touchdowns. Now 20. Receiving touchdowns, tied with Jamar Chase for most in a season in SEC history. He was tied with 100-yard receiving games within one season. Started the day with 7 with Amari Cooper. He now has 8, that record all by himself. And he was the dominant force, as it was very likely to be before the game even started.
Yeah, he's just such a matchup problem, and he just has such great understanding of how to run routes, how to attack coverage, leverage of defenders. And then again, Mac Jones has so much trust in him, and he's going to be where he wants him to be. Mac Jones, 25 of 30, just under 300 yards, 4 touchdowns. The big 3 did it again. Najee Harris, 125 yards rushing. A very, very difficult team to defend, because whatever you try to take away, they'll exploit something else.
As we spin it ahead, do you think they are clearly better than Clemson and or Ohio State?
I don't think clearly. I think they have been the best team from wire to wire. I think, you know, Clemson had a couple games without Trevor Lawrence. I think they're playing their best ball. Ohio State has had kind of a disjointed year, but they've got the talent to play with either one of those teams. So I really think that they're the best team, but they're capable of being beaten by either one of those teams that win tonight.
Well, this was the fifth win of the season for Alabama against a team ranked in the top 25. No other team in the country has even four. They are definitely deserving of that number one ranking. And when I think of Nick Saban and Alabama, you think of consistent excellence. This is 13 years in a row they've been number one in the country at least 1 week of a season. That is far and away the all-time record. They just roll it year after year.
Yeah, they do. And they just continue to recruit. They have another number one recruiting class.
Maybe the best they've ever had, we're told.
One of their best classes. They had nine guys drafted last year off of last year's team, and they just continued to build. They were 11-2 last year, thought it was a disappointing year. And then the other thing that is worth mentioning, they go undefeated. They win all their games this year, and it was a complete SEC schedule. There was no non-conference game. So they played a very, very difficult schedule and kind of dominated all the way through.
Well, Notre Dame better, but still a double-digit loss on the big stage. Alabama advances to the national title game presented by AT&T on ESPN at 8 o'clock Eastern, Monday, January 11th. Let's go down to the field now for the trophy presentation. Here's Allison Williams.
Thank you so much, and welcome to the trophy presentation for this Rose Bowl game, following another memorable matchup in the storied history of this great bowl game. First of all, we want to express our gratitude to Capital One for their support of college football and their sponsorship of the 2021 Rose Bowl game. Now, to present the Rose Bowl game's Leishman Trophy, here is the executive director of the college football playoff, Mr. Bill Hancock.
Thank you. First, I want to thank the Rose Bowl staff, with assists from the Cotton Bowl and AT&T Stadium, for the remarkable way they handled the transition of this year's Rose Bowl game. And thank you and congratulations to both these fine teams for your excellent seasons. You will remember forever that you had the opportunity to participate in this year's Rose Bowl game. And now it's my special honor to present the traditional Leishman Trophy for the 2021 Rose Bowl champions, and we will see you next week in Miami to coach Nick Saban and the Alabama Crimson Tide.
Well, first of all, I'd like to thank the College Football Playoff and Bill Hancock and the Rose Bowl folks and also the Cotton Bowl folks and AT&T Stadium for putting on this venue and handling it in such a first-class way. And I'd like to congratulate Notre Dame for being here and having an outstanding year. And can't tell you how proud I am of our players, our team, who earned the right to get in the national championship game. And this is something you always remember, playing, participating, and winning the Rose Bowl. This is fantastic. So you guys have done a great job all year. Everybody that supports the program, from our administration to our athletic director, have all done a fantastic job of helping us have a very successful program. And you guys have done a great job all year handling the disruptions and doing the things you need to do to have success. And thank you so much, man. I appreciate everything that everybody's done, all their effort, and all the things that you've done to have this kind of success and create this opportunity for yourself. Thank you.
Coach Saban, you alluded to it. This has been a season unlike any other. What did you learn about your team over the course of the season thus far when it came to their ability to adapt to the different challenges presented?
Well, I kind of told the players in the beginning of the season that this was going to be a different kind of season, that there'd be a lot of disruptions and a lot of things that we would have to adapt to, and the team that handled it the best would be the team that had the best chance to have success in the end. And these guys have done a fantastic job of doing that all year, and that's why they are where they are right now.
Thank you, Coach. You better set that down because we got some other hardware to hand out as well. We're going to start with offensive player of the game. 130 receiving yards on 7 receptions, 3 touchdowns, wide receiver Devontae Smith.
I want to shout out my teammates. I wouldn't be able to do none of this without y'all, with the defense just giving us great looks at practice all throughout the week. The offensive line, my quarterback, I can't do none of this without y'all. I appreciate y'all.
Devontae, this team is certainly full of weapons on offense, but we know it begins up front. And when you don't have a guy like Landon Dickerson out there, how did you guys go out there and still never miss a beat?
That's just everybody come to practice. Everybody always ready, no matter who it is. When one man go down, it's next man up, and everybody prepared for moments like this.
What is it like for you to play with the type of talent that you have around you and the connection that you have with your quarterback, Mac Jones?
It's a blessing just to learn different things from everybody on this team. Just everybody have their own ways of doing things, and you see the way these guys carry themselves, and it just rubs off on you.
What's it mean to you to be here standing as the Rose Bowl champs and knowing you're headed to Miami next week to play for the national championship?
It means a lot, but we're not done yet.
And now for the defensive player of the game, Patrick Surtain. Got a lot of confetti down here. Patrick, what has been the key to your guys' success defensively, week in and week out, and how did it culminate today here in the Rose Bowl?
Well, we focused on preparing for this game. Last week, we didn't finish like how we wanted to, so we had a chip on our shoulder, and you know, we worked in practice each and every day.
Thank you so much, Patrick. Congratulations to all the members of the Alabama Crimson Tide on a terrific performance here in the Capital One Rose Bowl game. Enjoy your trip to Miami. We'll see you in the national championship. Happy New Year, and thank you so much for being with us.
Fifth Rose Bowl championship for Alabama, first since 1946. 5-1-1 now all time in this classic. And on their way to try to win their 13th national championship in the bowl era, which dates back to 1936. Najee Harris with the signature play of this game. He and Jones and Smith were terrific. A great team win. 31-14 the final. For Todd Blackledge, Todd McShay, Allison Williams, our tremendous crew, we thank profusely for a wonderful season. Sean McDonough, so long. Back to Reese, Joey, and David Pollard.